Welcome to beautiful Orlando, Florida, and the Russell Athletic Bowl. 10th-ranked North Carolina, winners of the ACC Coastal against Baylor, 9-3 in the Big 12, all part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Larry Fedora, the North Carolina head coach in his fourth year. He's won 32 games, lost 19, the first ACC championship game in school history. And for the Baylor Bears, Art Briles, who has built a program the envy of everybody in the country, now in his seventh season as the head coach of the Bears.
And they won the toss and will take the ball. That's his son, Kendall Briles, right in front of him, the offensive coordinator. They're shorthanded today without Corey Coleman, the Biletnikoff winning wide receiver out because of sports hernia surgery. Seth Russell, Jared Stidham, of course, versus Jeffrey Schneckenstein. Quarterbacks are out. And Shaq Linwood, the running back, is out today as well.
Dave, thanks so much. I'd like to welcome the audience who watched the Military Bowl this afternoon. We welcome you to Orlando and our Russell Athletic Bowl. Chris Johnson, the Baylor quarterback, in his second start, he suffered a concussion against Texas in the first quarter, did not come back to that game. In the second half of Baylor's win at Oklahoma State, he threw for 138 yards, total three touchdowns on the season, 15 for 38, 220 yards, three touchdowns, and two picks.
Of course, Seth Russell, the starter who was playing wonderfully well until the Iowa State game, broke a bone in his neck, is out. And Jarrett Stidham broke a bone in his foot. Both of those guys out. And Johnson, you mentioned, was concussed in that first quarter against Texas. So he didn't even get a full rep at the quarterback then. They had to bring in a wide receiver, Lynx Hawthorne, to play quarterback. And he'll be the second string quarterback, that's Hawthorne, in this game.
Jefferson keeps his balance, takes it all the way out to the 42 for a first down. You'll probably see Johnny Jefferson play the wildcat spot as well as the tailback.
Yeah, before we got the full audience, I mentioned all the people that are out for Baylor. We just mentioned the quarterback, Shaq Linwood, the top receiver, out for Baylor as well.
This one is overthrown, intended for Chris Platt.
Well, and the list goes on. Corey Coleman, of course, he was the top receiver in college football, won the Fred Biletnikoff Award as such. He decided to have sports hernia surgery after the regular season ended. It was bothering him at the end of the season. He'll go to the NFL, should be healthy after that surgery. But Coleman out, Shaq Linwood, the top receiver, or top running back, and the two top quarterbacks not here for Baylor.
Johnson, read option, takes it to the 45.
Should mention for North Carolina, we found out just before the game, their best interior lineman, Nas Jones, is out with a concussion. So North Carolina not fully healthy here.
And Jalen Dalton, number 97, gets his spot. Jefferson again.
Well, this is a spot where Art Briles is going for it here, and I don't blame him. You're in a bowl game. You've got to keep your foot on the gas. You're right at midfield, fourth and short. Think of a run here.
Jefferson, keeper. Still on his feet to the 35-yard line. This is what they did against Texas when literally they had run out of quarterbacks. Jefferson, who has excellent feet, went to the wildcat spot. So did Terrence Williams.
And you have a very good offensive line. That's one thing Art Briles has done a terrific job in the last several years. Looks like we're going to get a procedure call.
Jay Lee moved early, one of the wide receivers. And Devin Chafin, number 28, has checked into the lineup.
But great call going for it, I think, on fourth and short, and an excellent job by the offensive line. Wonderful hole cleared out there. A good pull by the guard over to that side, Jarrell Broxton. Pat Colbert is out as well, the right tackle, and in
another
there right
flag.
Now. Blake Muir has moved over
offense
to right tackle.
55. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
And this has got to be, as an ex-offensive lineman, this has got to be a line of your dreams. Four of the five guys either made the first or second team all-star team in the Big 12.
And that's just when Art Briles and this staff got here, they started building with quarterbacks and receivers and running backs, but he knew that they would be able to get enough speed, so it became about the line, just like what Briles did when he was at Houston. recruiting and getting these guys ready. And so you're going to see, without many quarterbacks, a lot of Wildcat.
Lynx Hawthorne, the backup quarterback, the backup kick returner, the backup wide receiver, and now the Wildcat man turns the corner. Got to wear multiple hats now.
Well, with Art Briles' background, he played at the University of Houston, and they ran the veer there. And even though it's a spread hurry-up, and that's his son Kendall, who's the offensive coordinator, they run the ball a lot between the tackles. It's a power run game.
Hawthorne goes inside the 40.
When we were talking to Briles about his offense, he said, we're always going to go fast. We're probably always going to snap it more than any other team, but we will always have a power inside run game. And that's what you're seeing now with a good veteran offensive line and really struggling at the quarterback spot, moving the ball nicely on their first drive.
And the umpire steps in to stop this play. And often the running game gets lost when you think of Baylor. You think of guys like Corey Coleman and the great quarterbacks they've had, RG3 and so on.
Delay of game, delay. The offense was not set. Repeat, third down.
Well, here are the superstars that they are missing from this offense. Seth Russell, 29 touchdowns. He gets hurt. Jarrett Stidham steps in, doesn't miss a beat. The freshman just played brilliantly. Coleman won the Biletnikoff Award as the best receiver in the country, and Linwood only rushed for 1,300 yards. All those guys are gone, and they still think they can move the ball. Johnson. And flying up from the corner, Des Lawrence.
And fourth and 10, this is actually a place where you could go for it for Baylor, and here they go. We'll take a look at Johnson not having anything downfield. Good coverage. But Baylor now on fourth and inside of 10 deciding to go for it. Don't be surprised with a quarterback draw here. But I like this because if you punt it, goes in the end zone, there's no change in the field.
That's a backward pass. And Chafin can't get anything out of it. They'll turn it over on downs. Good play by Dominic Green, the number 26, the safety, who wouldn't let him turn the corner.
Well, first-year defensive coordinator Gene Chizik for North Carolina has done an amazing job. This defense has the most improved in the country from last year to this year, and that's a fourth and 9, and you get off the field. Look at Chizik standing up with the glasses on the nose there. Of course, former head coach at Auburn, won a national championship there in 2010 before being let go after the next season where they only won 3 games, kind of a head-scratcher.
He discovered that being in broadcasting was too easy, so he got back into coaching.
2 years in the booth, and his old friend Larry Fedora called. He turned him down the first time he called.
Marquise Williams, the quarterback, little option look. He'll keep and get 2. Williams comes in with responsible for 94 career touchdowns. That is a Tar Heel record. The senior quarterback has accumulated more than 10,000 total yards in his career. That's 5th in the ACC annals. And this season, almost 3,700 total yards, which is 2nd in North Carolina history to his own record. Comes out throwing on 2nd down and a strike to Quinshad Davis, who makes his 50th catch of the season. A young man playing with rods in both of his legs.
Key throw there. 3rd and short, expect a run here for North Carolina. But Marquise Williams did not play well in the throw game in the ACC championship game. So nice for him to get an easy throw that was on target. Now you'd expect an inside run maybe with Hood.
Instead, Hood goes into the flat. Williams looks that way, then turns to his right. Double pumps, throws over the middle, and he has the completion to Ryan Switzer, the leading receiver on this ball club with 52 catches before that. Let's take a look at tonight's keys to the game, brought to you by Franklin American Mortgage.
For North Carolina, and we just saw, keep the pass game relevant. That was a nice throw on the outcut to Davis. Keep that relevant, and for Baylor,
it was a running play by Hood. They'll pick up about 6.
Hood, again, good inside runner. But for Baylor, it's both lines winning. They're very good on the defensive line, very good on the offensive line.
Williams with a man in his face throws incomplete. Trying to get it to his tight end, Hendrick Singleton. But the pressure straight up the middle made him throw it poorly. And Sean Oakman, the right end, The right side of that defensive line with Oakland and Billings, the nose man, is really feisty.
Yeah, there's three seniors up there. The best one may be Billings on the inside. But again, you've got a third and short. Billings lined up right in the middle of your screen there. He's a guy getting his NFL grade, decided he's coming back for his senior year.
First team ESPN All-American, Big 12 D lineman of the year. Draws a double team every time. Pressure. Williams steps up and throws complete inside the 35-yard line. A beautiful pass that time to Mac Hollins, a gain of 18. Oakman had him and let him go.
Well, this is where a guy like Williams really helps you out, because that was just a beat to the inside by Oakman on the left tackle. I cannot say enough how important it is for North Carolina that the accuracy for Williams is there tonight. He said, keep the pass game relevant. He feels like he's in a better motion.
Just a stride too far for Hollins, who had a step.
Boy, that looked all to the world like Hollins was going to be able to run under that.
Sure did.
When this ball was let go, and Williams really struggled at times in the throw game this year. Excellent job working one-on-one with the best corner, Howard, from Baylor. But Hollins, who has a good long stride, just not able to run through it.
If he lays out,
he might get
have had a shot.
Yeah.
Keeper by Williams. Excellent fake. Gets all the way to the 22-yard line.
You know,
and that's really where he does most of his damage.
All the defensive coordinators, it was interesting. We were talking to Gene Chizik, the coordinator, defense coordinator for North Carolina. He hadn't coordinated a defense since 2005 when he was the coordinator for Mack Brown at Texas when they won the national championship. And he said in those 10 years, the inside run game for the quarterback, especially inside the 25-yard line, has been the biggest change.
Williams back shoulder throw incomplete, looking for Washington. And Damian Washington had outside position, but he was very well covered by Ryan Reed, number 9.
Trying to keep Baylor a little bit loose. You know that the run game is going to be key with Hood and Williams. But calling that throw on first down, making Baylor at least think about it.
The running back is T.J. Logan. Four-man rush, no pressure. Williams has all day. Looking, throws inside, complete, and Davis, touchdown, but there's a flag down. He may have stepped out of bounds before he came back in to make the catch.
The question is, did he go out on his own, or did he go out with contact from the defender?
Illegal touching of a pass. Offense number 14. Went out of bounds on his own. It was the first to touch the pass. Lost it down at the previous spot. Third down.
Great explanation by the referee to say he went out on his own.
If Davis, and he just lost where he was. You see this all the time. He's waiting for the ball. It looked like his left foot right before he caught it. Yeah, his left foot was out of bounds right before he caught it. You saw the flag come in. I mean, it was his toe that was out of bounds. And, of course, for North Carolina fans who had to sit through an offsides call on an onside kick they recovered late against Clemson, that's tough, still in their head. But that clearly Davis had. That one big toe was out of bounds before he came back in and caught it.
Third down. Part of that penalty is loss of down. Switzer to the 10. They'll mark it at the 11. It will be good enough for a first down. As the 5'10 junior ran a slant, and Williams hit him perfectly.
Williams in such a different rhythm throwing the ball than I saw against Clemson, studying that tape in the ACC championship game.
Logan for a couple.
And even with Baylor, with a lot of their offensive stars not at this game, if you're North Carolina, they've slowed the tempo down a little bit. There's not as much hurry up as they used to be. They can control this game. This is an offensive line. Most of them recruited by this coaching staff, starting to come together nicely.
Hood and Logan are in there together. The fake is inside. The pass intended for the tight end, Brandon Fritz. And another third down for the Heels offense.
And it looked like this was open and a touchdown. Fritz gets contact. Ball was on him just a little early. Nice physical contact by Chance Waz. That was a good job. You can put your hands on someone in college football as long as the ball is not gone. That was good physical defense. 14 at the top is a guy they like in the fade.
Williams again with all day to throw. Tight end Fritz, touchdown. If you've got that much time to throw the ball, you're going to find somebody. No pressure at all on Marquise Williams.
Williams has done a wonderful job moving around, finding guys, moving his eyes. This entire drive, he has looked like a whole different quarterback in the throw game than he was in the ACC championship game. And he had struggles against South Carolina early in the season. Was benched against Delaware. And Mitch Trubisky, a really good-looking backup quarterback who will likely take over starter next year, came in and played well.
Nick Weiler now 63 for 63 on point after. And Fritz gets his fourth touchdown catch of the year from the talented right arm of Marquise Williams. Welcome back to the Russell Athletic Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. North Carolina goes 69 yards on its opening possession in 13 plays. And puts 7 up against Baylor. Zamora and Platt are deep. Zamora, 3 yards in the end zone. He'll take a knee. We talked about North Carolina's defensive improvement. They are the most improved defense in the entire country. Of course, they were giving up 39 points a game. You figure they had to get better.
Well, Gene Chizik came in. He had been away for 2 years. There was no, he said, I was liking television. I had a life for the first time. Larry Fedora and he had coached against each other several times, and Fedora just continued calling and calling. Gene realized he had worked for Mack Brown. He knew that Chapel Hill was a wonderful place to live and raise a family, so made the change, and what a change it has been.
4 wide receivers set. They'll run out of it and only get a couple of yards.
And when we were talking to Gene Chizik getting ready for this game, and just what a wild ride this guy has had. He was left as the defense coordinator at Texas to go to Iowa State. Then he got the job at Auburn, was booed as he was getting off the plane because he hadn't had a winning season at Iowa State. There was a fan at Auburn booing when he got there. They win a national championship, and then the next year they lose 3 games. They start an NCAA investigation, which found absolutely nothing. Gene Chizik has been completely cleared of anything at Auburn. He just had a bad taste in his mouth. Wanted to get away from it, did for 2 years. Will likely be looked at again to be a head coach. He did win a national championship as a head coach.
That looks good on your resume.
Yeah, and he has some, you can tell he has some wounds from what happened at Auburn. And there's some unfinished business. And he has really enjoyed working for a guy like Larry Fedora, getting to know him, how positive Larry is, and what he's done with this program. He's really enjoyed it.
Try to hit a deep throw, and again, they had a wide open receiver, Johnny Jefferson. Excuse me, that was Katie Cannon, who was wide open by a step and a half, but Johnson missed him.
Well, the North Carolina corners are playing pretty tight coverage here. Cannon, one of the fastest guys in the country. Baylor has a lot of those. He ran right by MJ Stewart, and the safety, Donnie Miles, was late getting over there. North Carolina missing Sam Smiley, a starting safety who tore an Achilles against NC State in the last regular season game.
Chafin takes the direct snap. You will see a whole bunch of players, Johnson, Chafin, Jefferson, and probably Terrence Williams, taking shotgun snaps. And this is what this so potent offense has been reduced to.
It's a running game led by a law firm. If you saw the end of the Texas game, it looked like 1950s Veer single-wing football, and that's exactly what we're seeing tonight.
If you don't have an accomplished quarterback, and they have two tremendously accomplished quarterbacks who can't play, they're both hurt, then you are restricted to doing something like this. Who has a great third quarterback?
Almost nobody. But what I love here is they're going for it on fourth down again. Keep your foot on the gas. It's a bowl game. We don't have our quarterbacks. Let's make North Carolina defend every play. This is a manageable down and distance. Now they will run. They will throw the ball with Jefferson. Jefferson actually threw the last pass, the Hail Mary attempt against Texas. So you could see a throw here.
But he came in only 15 out of 38. Flanker screen. They'll get the first down and more. Zamora out there, and Jefferson with a good enough arm to sidearm it out there.
He may not have great mechanics, but Jefferson's got himself a little bit of an arm. And now you see, look at the tight spiral. That ball got over there in a hurry. Terrific throw, terrific blocking on the edge. And I love the fact that Art Briles is just laying it all out there. Fourth down, our side of the field. It's manageable. Let's give it a shot. It's a bowl game. We're missing all these guys. Let's have some fun.
Why not? Why punt it?
Yeah, absolutely.
What's the
not.
Point?
Not for, yeah, well, I mean, if you're 40 and beyond on their side of the field, I suspect they'll go the rest of the night.
Jefferson, direct snap, trying to pick his way. Gets it outside. Jefferson turns that into about 4 or 5 yards.
And there's Seth Russell and Jared Stidham. Stidham broke a bone in his ankle, and Seth Russell broke a bone in his neck, ducking his head to run late against Iowa State. Both of those guys will be back. It will be a very interesting spring practice. They'll both be healthy and ready. But Seth Russell was playing lights out. They were averaging 61 points per game when he was injured.
Cannon using his speed to pick up about 3 as he ran the width of the field.
You know, when we were talking to the coaches from Baylor, Art Briles kept talking about all the guys who were missing as inspirational. He really does have a way of flipping things, and not what we don't have, but came up through the high school ranks where you have to play with whatever shows up on the field, learned how to invent stuff on the fly.
Chafin, direct snap, trying to get the first down. It looks like they'll mark him inside the 20, and if so, it is a first down.
And if you have followed Baylor over the last 5 or 6 years and you're a college football fan and you're tuning into this game,
you go, what?
And Georgia Tech showed up all of a sudden. I mean, that's what it looks like all of a sudden, but that's what they have. They have a good offensive line. They have a bevy of good running backs, even with Shaq Linwood out. And you can see they're working. Briles is getting his money worth tonight.
Straight up the middle for 9 yards for Terrence Williams. His first appearance is a good one. He's 5'11", 6'2", 215, a redshirt freshman. And the fifth different man to take a direct snap so far in this ballgame.
You're next, Patrick.
Now, you don't want to stick around for that.
North Carolina does.
Yes. But this about improved defense.
And what's hard, if you're North Carolina, and you can see their defensive line and mention that Nas Jones was out. He's their best player by far in the middle. There's a lot of hands on hips right now. These guys are starting to get worn out a little bit with this inside run game.
First down. And a touchdown. Lynx Hawthorne. His 11th rush of the year and a Baylor touchdown.
Hawthorne, a guy who was a quarterback in high school but got beat out his senior year, switched to wide receiver, had to start taking snaps at quarterback, and I'm not sure that Hawthorne didn't take a hit on his thigh the way he's walking off there. I've been hit in that spot and had a thigh bruise. The way he's walking looks like he might have got hit in the thigh, and that's not good news. He's their second-string quarterback now with both Stidham and Russell out, but he had to start taking snaps at quarterback and going to those meetings.
And he's their primary punt returner. He's a little bit of do everything. Right now, he's the guy who tied North Carolina.
Texas Tech, where Art Briles got his start in the college ranks. He was, of course, a supremely successful high school coach in the state of Texas. He was hired by Mike Leach as a running backs coach when he first took the job at Texas Tech. So good roots for Briles. That's how he got his start in college. And, of course, became the head coach at Houston, where he had played and now has built a top 10 program at Baylor. You never would have thought it.
And this one will sail out of the end zone. We're at 7-7, first quarter with 4:25 to go from Orlando. Back after this.
ESPN, home of the New Year's Six and the college football playoff.
Welcome back to the Russell Athletic Bowl. It was just about a year ago after a disappointing 6-7 season for North Carolina. The head coach, Larry Fedora, called a no-holds-barred team meeting and said, I want to know what's wrong. I know it's not X's and O's, not talent. It's got to be mental. He told his coaches and players, write down what you think the issues are on a scratch piece of paper, sign it, and let's talk about it. There were things like chemistry, camaraderie, leadership. And after the meeting, they did vow that they would have all that this year. And indeed, after the opening loss, they won 11 in a row. What a difference one meeting made for the Tar Heels.
And Jerry, if people are honest in situations like that, you can really learn a lot.
And they said, you know, Mike, they said there were a lot of hurt feelings. A lot of the players said things that they didn't like about the coaches and how they were being handled. And Landon Turner, a senior who had been recruited by the previous staff, and that was where some of the chasm had happened between the old staff players and the new one. He said, I will be a leader. There's not going to be a problem with leadership. The guy's played great. He's a first-team All-American. I think he's got a bright future in the NFL. And what a difference a year makes.
Williams again with time, throws, and it's short and tipped. Avion Edwards got a hand on it, the outside linebacker.
Well, there was miscommunication there on coming back on that for Damian Washington, and now North Carolina in a situation that's not really great for them. Third and long is not a position that they want to be in, just like Baylor at the moment.
And Baylor looking for a way to get some pressure. They bring four, don't get there. Williams with plenty of time and a poor throw, but a flag is down. He was throwing for Quinshad Davis. Davis was tied up, and the pass was overthrown.
I'm wondering if that's catchable, though. That ball, Williams did not get to set his feet properly. That's what I saw in studying him. Sometimes his feet, when he's sometimes better when there is pressure. When there isn't, sometimes his feet mislead the throw a bit. But that ball really got away from him, and I'm wondering.
Pass interference. Defense number 9, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
It's Ryan Reed out of Sherman, Texas.
Here's Reed. Well, he's definitely, you've got to call that. I mean, you could have called defensive holding or pass interference here. So a flag is the right call. I think first down for North Carolina is right. This question was, which one was it going to be, defensive holding or pass interference? So either way, comes out the same.
Hood was the motion man. Williams keeps and gets to the 45. Doug Rhodes, former ACC coordinator, official. Should that have been better called as holding than interference, do you think?
Well, like Ed said, it could be either one. There was a hold earlier. Holding is holding regardless of whether it's catchable. But in that case, the rule says when in question, it's catchable, and I think that's correct.
Well, and if he didn't obstruct him, he may have been able to get much closer to that ball.
Correct.
As well.
You have to assume he could have gotten to it.
Yeah.
Hood on the toss. I wish, Doug, that they would just take the uncatchable thing and do away with it, because so many times the contact makes it uncatchable.
Correct. And that is a huge judgment for those deep officials.
Yes.
You know, is it catchable, trying to rule on that?
Yeah. Well, they may get a chance here. Third and long, they might get a deep one to judge.
Another chance.
But Baylor defensively is playing really well up front right now and in the secondary. And Williams, who's had his problems throwing the ball, being challenged to throw it.
Here comes pressure. Williams goes underneath, settles for the short gain. They'll bring up a fourth down. Xavier Howard on the coverage of Bug Howard.
Taylor Young coming off the edge, and Williams not able to step up into the pocket, but he's, you know, you're coming on third and seven to the underneath drag. If he steps up in, that's a 2-yard route. You've got to hit him right in stride. He's got to outrun the defender. But if Williams is able to step up, he had men open beyond the sticks.
Lynx Hawthorne is deep for Mangili's punt. Fair catch made at the 15, 37-yard kick. And no return. New Year's Eve, catch the college football playoff semifinals right here on ESPN at 4 Eastern. The Capital One Orange Bowl, number 4 Oklahoma against number 1 Clemson. Then at 8 Michigan State, number 2 Alabama in the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Both games on ESPN, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
Oklahoma Clemson is a run back of this Russell Athletic Bowl from last year. Clemson ran them out of the building 40-6 here in Florida. But after studying Clemson in the ACC championship game, we'd seen them earlier in the year, but after studying as a flag comes in for another procedure against Baylor, not surprised with all the changes at quarterback. But when I studied the ACC championship game, and we'd seen Clemson a couple times look really good on defense, their secondary played really poorly in that ACC championship game. If North Carolina could have just hit 5 or 6 passes that were wide open, I think they win that game. And as much as they struggled, if they don't play better against Oklahoma, I like Clemson a lot in that game, but Clemson looked really, really shaky in the secondary in that ACC championship game.
But do you think that
game
was an outlier and not an indication?
From what we saw earlier in the year, yeah, an outlier. But, boy, it was shocking.
Jefferson.
How much they looked.
Jefferson showing his speed across midfield into Tar Heel territory. 40 yards for Johnny Jefferson out of Killeen, Texas. What a burst.
Well, if you're just joining us, Shock Linwood, who holds the Baylor record for freshman rushers, the Baylor record for sophomore rushers, the Baylor record for junior rushers, is not with us today because of a foot injury he suffered against Texas. And so Jefferson and Williams and Lynx Hawthorne coming in as a second quarterback slash runner. Bunch of different guys touching the ball with Russell and Stidham, first and second string quarterbacks out.
Jefferson now 83 yards on 6 carries in the first quarter. He says, get another number we can call.
Get a blow, coach. Yeah, you're not coming out of a bowl game if it's going this well.
No, we'll tell you when you're tired. Jefferson, a little jump pass, had it batted down, and he was looking for Gus Penning, the tight end, who tried to sneak behind the linebackers.
Penning moved up in the depth when we're talking about guys not here. Trevon Armstead, the starting tight end, was dismissed earlier in the season, so even some depth issues there, but good defense by North Carolina.
I think somebody down there with a magic marker is crossing that play off. We're not going to see that one.
I bet you we see a jump pass in the goal line before this is over. The way they're running this offense, I think you have to have it in there. It's just Jefferson has to jump a little higher before he throws it next time. You have to do the jump before the pass.
Ah, I see.
And here's where you could take a throw down the field, by the way. You're going for it on fourth.
Hawthorne. Nice cut. Lynx Hawthorne. Out of bounds at the 2. Devin Chafin gave him a great block. And how can you go against a guy named Lynx?
And he, remember, on the touchdown he scored, it looked like he may have banged his right thigh or hip. Boy, that is a nice block. But that cut right there on Donnie Miles, and then just trying to outrun the other safety, Dominique Green. But this is a guy who, yeah, he's a second-string quarterback. There's the out-of-bounds. But he's a 4-4-40 and has a great first and second step. And now we see a nice change of direction.
He's lucky he stepped out of bounds, because the way he threw that ball forward, he'd have lost it. Chafin takes the direct snap. Drilled at the line of scrimmage. And it was Shaquille Rashad, the leading tackler on this ball club, who they moved the linebacker from defensive end. And what a job he has done with 110 tackles on this season coming in.
Chafin came up grabbing at his face mask like he'd been grabbed by it. I did not see that live.
Here comes Laquan McGowan, all 410 pounds of him as a blocking back. He's number 80. He could be number 800. You'd even go with that.
They will throw it to him. He had a touchdown catch in last year's bowl game against Michigan State.
Just a blocker this time, and Chafin dives into the end zone. Every time you see McGowan, you start to assume they're going to go that way. Why not?
How? How fun is this to watch a coaching staff like Baylor? And give the whole entire offensive staff, you know, everyone talks so much about Art, but his son, Kendall, a really good up-and-coming young coach, now the offensive coordinator, took over for Phillip Montgomery, who went on over to Tulsa last year from the OC as the offensive coordinator. But this staff, Art Briles kept talking about how this was an inspiration to try to play without these guys. And you feel it. They've got 14 on the board, and we're not even out of the first quarter. And their four best players are not playing.
Callahan has made 112 straight extra points. A great block by Gus Penning, leaving Devin Chafin into the end zone. I'm easily impressed.
Well, if you're tuning in seeing that 14 for Baylor, you think, oh, that's just normal. They score a lot. Well, they don't have their top two quarterbacks or the Biletnikoff winning wide receiver or their 1,300 rushing yard running back, but yet they're still manufacturing a pretty nice offense.
Francis on the return for the Heels. Francis has a seam, looks for another block, lost the ball, but it's out of bounds. North Carolina will maintain possession. Excuse me, we are told that is Mike Hughes, not Chris Francis. Both wear number one.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 8 on the kicking team. 15 yards from the end of the run, automatic first down.
It's Ishmael Zamora who's called for the personal foul. You've already got the big return.
You can see Art Briles really upset about it. He's upset about the call or Zamora, we're not sure.
As the ball goes out of bounds at the... Oh. Yeah, no doubt.
Cheap shot after the play's over by 3 seconds.
Got to be smarter than that.
So a good break for Carolina. Hood, only a couple, thrown back by a gang tackle. What a first quarter between North Carolina and Baylor. The Bears on the ground have a 7-point lead over North Carolina into the first 15 minutes. Drive recap.
Well, North Carolina like to square things up. They need to have the drive like they did in their one touchdown drive. Started when Mark Quis Williams avoids Sean Oakman and finds Hollins down the field. You always know that Williams is going to get involved in the zone read game. Once again, moving his feet, though, and this time was able to find a wide-open Brandon Fritz, a tight end who lines up as a wide receiver as they get near the goal line.
That was his 22nd touchdown pass of the year. He's thrown only 9 picks. Hood, his running back, as they start from the Baylor 39. Williams off target there, intended for Mac Hollins, who averages a startling 25 and a half yards a catch.
And a little change in play calling. Seth Luttrell, who was calling the plays at North Carolina, took the head coaching job at North Texas. And so the coaches have kind of moved that around. Co-offensive coordinator Gunnar Brewer, of course, involved, but Keith Heckendorf, who serves as the quarterback's coach, is upstairs, and he's the guy who's actually calling the offensive plays today for North Carolina.
A little pressure coming at the end here as Williams throws for the sideline and throws complete to Quinshon Davis. That'll be enough for a first down. And sometimes you look at Marquise Williams and you go, boy, isn't he good. Then he'll throw 3 or 4 passes that aren't even close.
He just struggles in the consistency, and when you study it, it's a lot of his feet. He doesn't trust stepping into his throw all the time. He has a little habit of falling backwards. But he's a dynamic athlete, obviously great in the run game. And when he can make people miss, like we saw in the drive recap, that's always helpful.
Fakes to Hood, moves out of the pocket. Throws underneath to Elijah Hood.
And here's a look at Keith Heckendorf, who was went away for a year, came back as the quarterback's coach, so his second stint here at North Carolina under Larry Fedora. But he has called plays before at Western Carolina, and so there will be a hire on the staff. Not sure who's going to be elevated to play caller, but with Seth Luttrell on to be a head coach, that's two coordinators in a row from Larry Fedora's staff going on to be head coaches.
Williams again. Nice strike this time inside the 15-yard line. And that's Bug Howard, whose given name is Jonathan.
6'4", 215 pounds. They have a lot of size on the outside as they get closer here. Inside run game with the quarterback and Hood, and throws to the outside.
Hood stops shy of the 10-yard line.
There's nothing like the view from the blimp. If you're going to study film, there is no better angle than directly above the field. Nice, you could see the transfer of weight stepping into it. That's a pretty nice shot.
You got to like so far what the Baylor defense has done, and give Phil Bennett credit. He says, we play so many more snaps because of our offense than other people. Judge us on things like points per possession, where we're number four in the country. And he's got a valid point. Williams, little swing and incomplete. Right in the hands of Austin Prohl. And if your last name's Prohl, you got to catch him.
Yeah, Ricky Prohl is his father, who played 17 years in the NFL. And you could see the younger Prohl there. He was looking at his block. Just that one split second. Took his eye off it. And he may have had a block.
He played with his dad. He was one of the best ever as far as hands.
4 years and only remember one drop from his father that I recall.
That may be Austin's last one. Williams just tripped up, had a chance to get to the outside, and tripped up by Avion Edwards, who had him by the ankle and will force a field goal try. Big play by Edwards.
Edwards doing an excellent job. He's the spy, making sure when Williams drops back, he's got to keep his eyes on the quarterback. That's terrific. Close the distance. And Williams still almost snuck out of that.
Boy, if he doesn't get him, it's a big yeah. play. Weiler, who has had a terrific year. This team only made 5 of 8 field goals last year with Weiler. This year, he's 19 of 22. Now make it 20 of 23. That was a 32-yard effort to cut the lead to 4. Both teams doing very, very well on offense so far.
A nice chance for Dak Prescott at Mississippi State to grow his records. We saw a game where he had 500 yards of total offense and was really the only offense they had against Arkansas. He won it late with a blocked field goal.
Zamora and Platt are deep for Baylor. Kick is blasted out of the end zone. And our opportunity to check in with Reese Davis. Reese.
SportsCenter right now brought to you by Great Clips. Jared Goff played what many believe will be his final college game. 6 touchdown passes, more than 400 yards through the air as Cal beats Air Force 55-36. Third game in his career that Goff has thrown for 6 touchdowns.
He's had quite a career at Cal, hasn't he? Johnson set to take the snap. Wants to throw on first down. Now trying to buy some time, and Chris Johnson throws it away. Here's Jerry Punch.
Art Briles is just so humble, guys, when he's praised about his ability to develop young players. He said, you know, I'm not sure I can make anyone better, but I can make them believe they're better. I recruit an intelligent, talented, and coachable young man. I make him comfortable and confident. Then he believes in himself, and he believes in my system. That's why we can put running backs in the Wildcat and make them play like quarterbacks.
And Jerry, he said the same thing of Chris Johnson. He says he has it in him. We have to get it out of him. He'd say the same thing about Chafin, who's taking this direct snap. And you can't tell the Wildcat quarterbacks without a scorecard.
Five different guys who have taken snaps from center, and this is not good news for North Carolina. A big body down. Nas Jones, as we reported earlier in the game, not playing because of a concussion. Looks like it's potentially Mikey Bart. I saw the four, couldn't tell it was 45, but Mikey Bart, who's one of their most productive defensive ends.
Sure is. Leads them in sacks. It looks like, I believe, Jeremiah Clark. We'll check when
right.
we
yep.
come back.
And Progressive, comparing rates to help you save. Now that's Progressive.
Yesterday, the Tar Heels had a pep rally at the Orlando Eye, an enormous Ferris wheel. I hate those things. You don't go anywhere, and they're more than 3 feet off the ground. There's Jeremiah Clark, able to get off the field under his own power. Jerry Punch, you have more?
Yeah, Jeffrey Spang, orthopedic surgeon, checked him. Clark's left shoulder, good range of motion, good strength. Checked him for maybe a little stinger. Putting the helmet back on, probably going to head back on the field here very quickly.
Thank you, Doc.
Well, we already mentioned Nas Jones out. That's another big body in the middle. You're going down the depth chart if he's not able to go.
Third down, about five.
Hawthorne the better if there is a better short thrower. Johnson more of a long thrower, so this could be a short throw by Hawthorne, not guaranteed to be a run.
Hawthorne a little swing. That's not going to get much. Terrence Williams makes the catch, stopped about 3 yards shy of a first down by Donnie Miles, the safety. Hawthorne comes into this game hitting 10 out of 22 passes. Remember, he's a kick returner, a backup wide receiver, and after all the injuries, they moved him to backup quarterback. The fourth different Baylor passer, the fifth different player to take a snap from center. Switzer is deep. He's an all-ACC kick returner. And there's a flag down, contact with the punter, and a tremendous kick. Switzer all the way back to the 20-yard line. Drew Galitz.
North Carolina brought the full pressure. And
yards in the defense. Yardage results in a first down.
Yeah, the North Carolina comes with a full-on rush, and a body came free on the right side.
Romar Morris.
Yeah. And Doug Rhodes, we bring in the former head officials, ACC. This is a pretty easy one, isn't it, Doug?
Yes, it is. In other words, if he gets any piece of that ball, you'll excuse the contact, but he didn't. And that's a very vulnerable position, that kicker. So that's clearly a
personal problem. We should check Galitz. He's got a little smile on his face now. I think the grab of the ankle was part of Baylor's acting department.
They're such fakes.
Well, he didn't have to do that. It clearly was roughing the kicker, but he certainly gave it the soccer grab of the shin.
Once again, this wildcat formation. This is Terrence Williams.
Let's call it the
Art Briles is doing everything he can to produce an offense.
Let's change it to the Bearcat for the Baylor Bears tonight. We'll call it the Bearcat.
Okay.
The Briles Cat.
Stop while you're ahead. Chafin across midfield, down to about the 48. McGowan, the 410-pound tight end, throws a block. And here are the players that have taken direct snaps. Hawthorne, Chris Johnson, who started at quarterback, quote-unquote. Terrence Williams, Johnny Jefferson has had the most success back there. And Devin Chafin. I think they're probably out right now.
Laquan McGowan, the former 400-pound offensive lineman who was moved to current fullback at 400 pounds. It's a little unfair going one-on-one against Jeff Schottmer, the middle linebacker. Schottmer does his thing, but it's not enough.
Jefferson near the 10. Still laughing about McGowan. He does open holes, doesn't he?
Athletic enough to move around. But Art Briles, he talks all the time. He said, we're going to go fast, but we're always going to be one of the best running teams in the conference, and we're going to do it running between the tackles. So even though they've had to pare down their offense, almost no throw game down the field, they do this stuff a lot. Even when they have the quarterbacks, even when they have who they want, they're running this type of offense enough that this isn't all new stuff. They're just having to do more of the inside run, more of the Bearcat, we're going to call it, for the rest of the night. But they're used to doing this stuff a lot.
First down just outside the 10. Jefferson fakes a look at a throw. Jefferson up the middle. Touchdown. Nice block by Spencer Drango, the offensive lineman of the year in the Big 12. Big number 58 from his left tackle spot. First team Walter Camp All-American gets the block.
Well, here's Drango. We saw McGowan get a nice block in space before. Terrific job. And the middle linebacker, Schottmer, because he's got to go over to the side where he was just blocked a little late getting over there. But good. This offense is pretty neat.
Good luck as a safety if you're 190 pounds and you have to stand in there against a 320-pound tackle who's got a bead on you.
And showed some nifty feet, too.
How about this for the Baylor Bears? We don't need a quarterback. We can score on anybody, anyway. That's going to be fun. And this has been fun so far, too. A lot more fun for Baylor than it has been for North Carolina, of course. The Heels are going to get the ball back with 9:35 to go first half. Francis and Logan are deep. Logan takes it on the hop at the 5. Runs into traffic at the 20 and dives forward. Well, they call it the New Year's 6. Two of the greatest days for college football fans. Starts Thursday, New Year's Eve, noon Eastern on ESPN. Followed by the playoff semifinal games between number 4 Oklahoma, number 1 Clemson. That's a 4 o'clock start. Then number 3 Michigan State, number 2 Alabama at 8 on New Year's Day. Three more tremendous games kick off 2016. All of these games on ESPN and streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. It's great that you can now stream everything. Williams. Got to think that Baylor defense is really inspired by what the offense has done.
Yeah, and totally rested. Edwards does another nice job. He seems to be the guy. And be careful there, coming in late to clean that up. But Edwards seems to be the guy who is mirroring number 12 and doing a nice job of it. But you mentioned they have to feel good about that offense. They were over there relaxed a little bit. I hope their hamstrings are stretched out.
Logan, the running back. Williams retreating all the way to the 1 yard line. Throws it toward the 30, and that is a complete pass.
It's got to drive you nuts.
Nice job by Quinshad Davis to come back and get it.
And if you're Phil Bennett, the defensive coordinator, you had two guys beat offensive linemen up front. They can't get them.
And credit Williams. He threw that where only his guy was going to get it.
Third and short. You suspect that this would be a run. Maybe Elijah Hood, who's a good inside runner. But this is also an opportunity to maybe let one go down the middle of the field.
Hood is the big back. He'll go out in the flat. Williams throws over the middle to his tight end, Fritz. And he's got enough for the first down. Brandon Fritz, a good target at 6'4", 245. Slow to get up. And wobbly.
It didn't look to me like he took a hit to the head. But as he is standing there, he looks awfully wobbly. Well, yeah, you could see him lower his head, and that was a Chance Waz did a good job of just coming in with his shoulder. He was not launching into him, but as he went down, I'm wondering if he didn't hit his head as he, because his arms were pulled down. Excellent job by Waz. Almost fumbles. And yeah, he just,
I think he's contact with the ground more than anything else.
And Blackshear, a 300 pounder coming over the top. Yeah, because that was a nice clean tackle by Waz. And unfortunately, this is a guy that you've seen they use so much. They move him away. I know he's listed as a tight end, but redshirt freshman out of Ohio. Waz did an excellent job, took the shoulder in, was not launching into the player. Fritz, a guy that obviously is a big part of their middle throw game.
And now for the latest dish, brought to you by Dish. Later tonight, LSU, Texas Tech, then Auburn and Memphis. The Belk Bowl will have NC State and Mississippi State Wednesday at 3:30, then Texas A&M and Louisville to cap off your Wednesday bowl action.
Texas A&M, a team that Baylor now has to go head-to-head with in recruiting. And I've seen a lot of recruiting services going into this signing period for Art Briles and his team, and some people thinking that Baylor may have the best recruiting class of all of the teams in Texas.
And he has developed a program where he can do that year after year. You go back 10 years and tell somebody, hey, look, Baylor will be able to compete in the Big 12 every single season, have great recruiting classes year after year, and it just laughed at you.
Well, and week 4, 5, 6, before their quarterback gets hurt, they could have competed with everybody, and I'm not sure if Seth Russell stays healthy that they're not in the playoff this year.
Oh, I think they are.
For the college football championship, so not just compete in the Big 12, but what Briles has been able to do.
And Avion Edwards with another big tackle as they will walk with Fritz back to the locker room. You would imagine he would undergo, as wobbly as he was, the concussion protocols that have been developed, and he's still a little unsteady. Third down, call it 2. Tar Heels need to keep the ball and get something on the board again.
Prior to the snap, charge, timeout, North Carolina. They're first.
We'll also take a timeout with 6 minutes 48 seconds to go. First half, it's 21-10 Bears. I ain't trying to live with it. The state of mind. And now for our Aflac trivia question. Marquise Williams has been responsible for 95 touchdowns in his career, the third most in ACC history. Who has the most? I think I know this.
Still playing in the NFL?
Then I don't know this.
Because I have a guess. Big third down here for North Carolina. They have to stay on the field. They cannot put their defense out that's given up already 258 rushing yards in the first half. They can't put them back out.
Hood. Boy, nice job by Elijah Hood, because he was hit behind the yard to make and then drove forward on second effort, or they don't get it.
It's a good get. Talking about recruiting, I was mentioning the nice job of Art Briles, but that Larry Fedora has done. Hood was a guy who committed to Notre Dame. Big, powerful back from Charlotte, North Carolina, and they flipped him to come to North Carolina, and Fedora and his staff starting to have success against some of the big top-name schools in recruiting.
Williams with time wants to go deep, throws it up for grabs, and it's picked off by Edwards. Avion Edwards. Check it, Ryan Stewart, 28, not 20. And Stewart's back to the 33-yard line. Perhaps his receiver stop broke off the route. Williams doesn't know that when he throws it. It's not his fault.
And you could see Larry Fedora right there yelling at Switzer for coming off his route. Definitely going to the post over the top. He comes back and he saw it, and Switzer had just completely stopped his route. What you hope is if he continues, at least he could play defense on this ball. But, boy, yeah, he just stopped. He just thought the play was over and came off of his route. There was two guys there, so he probably thought, no way the ball's coming my way.
But you still can't quit because that's what happens.
And Fedora, who was a wide receiver himself at Austin College, he's a native of Texas.
And that interception will go down on the record of Marquise Williams, but not his fault.
Well, Switzer would have had to make a nice breakup to stop it.
Jefferson. Incomplete. Had a receiver out there, Davion Hall. And Hall was looking where he was going rather than trying to take the ball in. Baylor, 25 turnovers forced this year. That's 19th in big-time college football.
And that's Phil Bennett in the yellow shirt. Longtime defensive coordinator. He's a former player at Texas A&M.
Jefferson again.
Phil Bennett spent a lot of time with him the other day at practice. He has really enjoyed his time. He worked for a long time for Bill Snyder at Kansas State, one of the great head coaches in the game. And having a time now to work with Art Briles, he says it's just been so much fun. He's so positive, so creative. And what we have to learn on defense is what's good defense? Takeaways and an occasional stop. If you can do that, then you're playing good enough defense the way we play offense.
And by the way, he's the only one down there with a yellow shirt, so his kids can find him.
Good. He really does stand out in that yellow shirt.
Or he just likes yellow shirts. I'm not sure which.
That's pretty smart. Now,
and
if your defense
will
is
use a timeout.
Now, if your defense is playing poorly, does he switch to a green shirt so no one can tell who he is?
Now, the answer for our Aflac trivia question, which was Marquise Williams has been responsible for 94 Aflac touchdowns in his career, the third most in ACC history. Who has the most? I've gotten three right this year. That is a five-year record for me. Taj Boyd, Clemson, 133. Second, who I'm sure you were thinking of, Phillip Rivers at North Carolina State. And how versatile Marquise Williams, 59 passing touchdowns. He's rushed for 33, and here's the kicker. He's caught three. May have to catch one today for the Heels to win. Jefferson. Nice cut to the outside. He is very quick and very elusive.
Jeremiah Clark, the defensive lineman they were checking his shoulder, is back in. But this, Baylor's going to run for over 400 yards today, the way this is feeling right now. The record for the bowl is 325. I think they're going to blow it out of the water. I just don't think it's going to be close.
Well, he's already had a huge half.
Yeah.
146 yards rushing as a team, 275 so far.
Yeah, the defensive line, they're missing Nas Jones, their best defensive interior lineman out, and they are getting worn down. Now they bring the 400-pound lead back.
They just followed McGowan
in,
He's mouthing off to one of the smaller defenders as he walked.
Yeah, this has got to be just a blast for the big bodies for Baylor. This offensive line has to just be having a ball.
And he's an athletic 400-pounder as well. Flags down everywhere as Ishmael Zamora gets a carry.
It was Ishmael Wilson tied up with a defender from North Carolina whose helmet came off. And that looked like what they were calling. We mentioned all the guys missing for Baylor on offense.
Personal foul, hands to the face. Defense number 68. 15 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat first down.
He means offense.
Offense, yeah. That's Ishmael Wilson, transfer from Texas A&M.
Well, yeah, so the helmet came off of the North Carolina player, but because of the foul...
It was taken off.
Correct. He doesn't have to come out for the play. That's what we weren't able to hear. 68 Green, the hands to the face, good call. And because that comes off, then the defender on that side, who I believe was Mikey Bart, who lost his helmet, doesn't have to come off. But after the penalty, Wilson has to come off, but they're short. Pat Colbert, the normal starting right tackle, out with a shoulder injury. So they're rotating some guys in there.
Second and a mile now. Carried by Terrence Williams.
Williams, a guy who has really benefited from the strength and conditioning program here at Baylor, which is just, by all accounts, a world-class program.
Williams again on third and nine, slipped a tackle inside the 40. 35, tries to spin out of another one, finally dragged down by Dez Lawrence, but a terrific run on third and nine for a first down, and they are just crushing the heels up front.
There is no penetration. The white jerseys are just stuck to green jerseys. And I was mentioning the improvement that Williams has made in the strength and conditioning program under Kaz Kazadi, the head strength coach. He has lowered his 40 time from 4.68 to 4.42.
Loose ball. North Carolina recovers.
They're calling incomplete pass.
Jeremiah Clark, who was hurt earlier, got on top of the ball. They're saying it was a forward pass.
Yep.
Yep.
You know, it's crazy, though, that you would think everyone in the world on defense is thinking, get that ball, but excellent officiating.
Well, depending on your angle, it looked like a handoff.
Yeah, you couldn't tell. And if he hadn't have flipped the ball but handed it and they mishandled the handoff, then it would have been a fumble. But because of the flip, it becomes a pass.
Second and 10. Hawthorne. Dragged down back at the 37-yard line. Shaquille Rashad. This is a big stand for North Carolina.
That's what I was just going to say. This is a big down right here to try to hold these guys to a field goal. But if you're Baylor, they've been going for everything inside fourth and five. So they don't have to pick it all up here. Is there something they can get on Gene Chizik's defense that gets them 7 or 8 and lets them go for it on fourth? Johnson, not a good intermediate thrower. He has trouble with the short game. Ball doesn't come out quickly. So in the throw game, if they're going to throw anything, typically here, it might be a longer throw to the outside.
Fierbauer is in there as an extra blocker. Williams throws, and is it inbounds? It is.
And not sure that you're kicking a field goal here.
That was KD Cannon, by the way, who was their leading receiver with Corey Coleman out.
This is a down and distance. Looks like he controlled it through the catch down and distance, where on the yard line it's a too long field goal for it.
Straight up the middle goes Jefferson. Touchdown Baylor. And I tell you what, if you go back to that previous play, it looked like the first thing that hit the ground was out of bounds. That should have been an incomplete pass. Spencer Drango again with a block that opened everything up.
This has been a wonderful job. Look at the washdown, the right side of that offensive line. Jarrell Braxton just blew up the entire right side of the line. But we'll go back, Mike. We'll take another look at that catch. On first look to me, It looked like he had control. It's allowed to touch the ground, but it's whether he had control or not.
But I don't think he had none of his body parts touched in bounds before he landed out of bounds. So we'll check it. But right now, Baylor just having its way with North Carolina's defense. Back in Orlando, just a beautiful stretch of weather down here. Temperatures between 75 and 85 degrees since we got here. Baylor with the lead now, 28-10 over North Carolina, and the Heels have to get it going on offense because their defense just hasn't been able to stop the Bears' rushing attack.
Mike, you brought up a good point. I was watching for the ball of whether it hit, but you were questioning whether the receiver's body was in bounds after catching this ball. You know, if you go back, and it's the left foot, when does that leave the ground? I think they wouldn't overturn it. They would
yeah,
not overturn
right.
it.
Yeah, right.
His foot, I mean, if you reviewed this, and maybe they should have stopped and reviewed it, but if you reviewed this, this would not have been overturned. I
no,
think that they
close.
Would say, yeah, that the foot was very close for Cannon and for North Carolina fans, of course, the arms crossed after not getting that onside kick against Clemson, which was not reviewable, whether their guys was offsides or not. But that one, even if reviewed, would have stand. Would
Williams,
have stood.
Not sure if that was a called run or not, but he takes off and gets to the 35. They have 2 minutes and 3 seconds and two timeouts to work with, do the Tar Heels of North Carolina.
If I'm Baylor and they start stumbling, I might start thinking about my two timeouts. Keep your foot on the gas. This has been an amazing first half for this depleted offense at Baylor.
Blitz coming. They don't get there, and it's a good thing the pass went a little stronger. That's a pick six the other way for Reed.
Reed and Davis having a little conversation there, but Marquise Williams just gets absolutely drilled as he throws the ball, and the clock stops. So you saved Baylor that timeout potentially.
To the outside, TJ Logan. Big game for Logan into Baylor territory. Clock will stop temporarily while they move the sticks. Logan more the speed back. Mm-hmm. Hood is the big power guy.
And that's a huge pickup on third and one for North Carolina. If for any other reason, so that they don't give the ball back to a red-hot Baylor.
Williams, good protection this time, unloads. Pass is underthrown and almost intercepted. Xavier Howard had the best shot at it. Mac Hollins was open, and Williams underthrew him by about 5 yards.
And this was what, in studying the tape, we saw with Williams. Just struggles with the downfield throws. Excellent job by Hollins just to adjust enough to come back and make Howard, who has 5 interceptions on the year, fight for it. But you're right, Hollins had a step, and bad news for Baylor as first-team All-Big 12 corner Xavier Howard comes off.
And he was named by the coaches. Several teams, of course, everybody wants to pick an all-conference team, but that's the one you want to make the most because they know who the players are. Second and 10.
False start. Offense number 70. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
Coming up on the Coke Zero Halftime Report, Reese Davis, Butch Davis, and Joey Galloway will join us from the Orange Bowl in Miami. Some of the topics they'll be talking about: the Miami Report Sooners run game and the Cottontail, Spartans' stingy defense.
Everyone's been talking about Alabama's defensive front. We saw Michigan State. They're pretty good up front, too. Malik McDowell, one of the better inside interior linemen that we saw all year.
But isn't Alabama just a cut above anybody on defense?
On defense, in the front seven, yes. Although offensively, they have a few things you could attack.
Williams, quarterback draw. Got the first down and more. Heck of a run by Marquise Williams. 20 yards, and they really needed it. Got away from Orion Stewart, who finally pushed him out of bounds.
Well, when things have gone right for North Carolina, it's been with this guy running. And right away, you could tell that that was going to be a run. When you see the big body of Landon Turner that far downfield, this was a called quarterback draw. Nice job. Remember, we mentioned Keith Heckendorf now calling plays with Seth Luttrell gone to North Texas.
Plenty of time for them to work. Williams wide open and broken up at the last second. Ryan Switzer was open and just crushed as the ball got there, and there is a flag down.
I believe
Ryan Reed drilled him at the same time the ball got there.
And his mouth is bleeding, and I'm not sure that we're not going to see a targeting and an ejection against Baylor. And let's hope Switzer gets looked at. He looked bright-eyed. He didn't look like he was hitting the head, but you can see it clearly hitting the mouth. His mouth is bleeding. He's a defenseless player by definition because he's going to catch the ball.
What a shot he took. And it is a targeting call.
So they call Ryan Reed for targeting. They will not eject Reed until they look at this.
That's a shoulder to the shoulder,
well,
isn't it?
Well, it doesn't matter the body part. It's if there is forcible contact to the head or neck area. And that picture there, let's see if there's any forcible contact by any body part by Reed.
That's shoulder
Boy, that
to
looks,
shoulder.
That to me does not look like Reed makes forcible contact.
Nope.
To the helmet of Switzer moves, but it did not look to me like there was forcible contact to Reed in the head or neck area.
If you get drilled like that, everything's going to move.
Right.
Your head, the helmet,
right.
Everything. That doesn't mean there was forcible contact.
Yeah, and just because Reed leaves his feet and launches, there still has to be forcible contact to the head or neck area. Let's go nice and slow through the hit.
No.
See, Reed's head's off to the right. The hard part is, here's the hard part. You can't tell if Reed's helmet makes forcible contact with Switzer's. It looks like they may touch.
We are trying to teach kids to use their shoulder, not their helmet. He used his shoulder to make the strike.
Again, it doesn't matter what body part. Targeting does not matter if you make forcible contact to the head or neck.
But I'm saying he didn't. He used his shoulder to make the hit.
Right.
Doug Rhodes, what do you see there?
This is one of the toughest calls of all, but the forcible contact, that language was added last year to help the official. To me, this looks like the initial force is at the shoulder, and then obviously his head's going to rock and move with that kind of impact. But I think that initial force comes at the shoulder.
After further review, there is no foul for targeting on the previous play. As a result, number 9 is not disqualified from the game. It'll be 2nd and 10 on the 29-yard line. Please adjust the game clock to 1 minute, 11 seconds.
As much as officials are rightfully so focused in on targeting and player safety, I think that is an exceptional call by this officiating crew to turn around and say that was not targeting.
And I think what you make a good point. Reed did what he should be doing. He came in with a shoulder instead of trying to blast through the head with his headgear. He also, I'm not sure, Doug, if they would have gotten the targeting, I'm not sure that he actually launched himself into it. So I'm glad that got called
correct
off.
It still says when in question it's a foul. Yep. The official at full speed, that's when in question.
Yeah.
So 2nd and 10 for Marquise Williams. Pressure coming. Williams runs again, and he's got enough for a first down, although they mark him back. It looks a little bit back from where he went down. Still a first down.
You got to go fast here. You don't want to burn a lot of clock. Even though you have these two timeouts, you want as many plays as you can possibly have to score a touchdown.
Williams again to the end zone. Incomplete. In and out of the hands of Quinshad Davis, and Ryan Reed was there again.
Davis, the guy who caught the touchdown in overtime to beat Frank Beamer in Virginia Tech in Beamer's last game. This time he comes on. It's that left arm of the defender, Reed, who, if Reed was kicked out, would not have been there. So a good reversal to call for Baylor. But Reed had the left arm in there and was able to knock it out. Good defense.
Looked like Williams was trying a back shoulder throw, and that was a pretty good throw. Hood. Get about 3 to the 16. They will stop it with a timeout. Still plenty of time left. 49 seconds and one timeout that you've still got in your pocket.
And I like the idea of getting a run in there, especially when you have the two timeouts. Just try to keep Baylor off guard. Your quarterback has struggled in the red zone. Remember, The problems for Marquise Williams a lot of times have been as they get down closer into the red zone. He threw two interceptions in the loss to South Carolina in the end zone. And so Marquise Williams is a guy that if you're in here, you have to have the run game.
Aerial coverage being brought to you tonight by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you've got to get DirecTV.
I'm telling you, that's a fake blimp. I think DirecTV
sent a fake blimp. That looks pretty good.
Flies awfully close to the stadium. But what you've got, you're third down here. You have another timeout. What you don't want, oh, there it is. That is an actual blimp. What you don't want to do is, I don't think you want to use that timeout for any type of run or anything. I think everything you want to be beyond the sticks or near the sideline from here on out. You may need
third
that for
down,
a field
they
goal.
Do not want to go for a field goal. Williams under pressure now. And throws it out of bounds. He almost, now there's a flag down all the way back at the 30-yard line. Another one at the 23. And there are players on the ground all over the place.
And this could be a big penalty because now you're starting to get back into out of field goal range potentially for Nick Weiler. He can kick from a 50-plus.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Number two's helmet came off through play, and he continued to participate during the play. Half the distance to the goal. First down.
That is such a difficult rule. Sean Oakland
really
lost his helmet by rule. You are required to stop and not be part of the play anymore, but that goes against every competitive nature in your body.
It is incredibly hard. Well, the helmet was knocked off, and it is lucky that North Carolina didn't get called for a hands to the face. But even then, he would have had to have stopped.
Yes.
And not continued to play. What a huge break now for North Carolina. What looked like they were going to be backed way up potentially. Now they get a first and goal with 40 seconds and a timeout. A lot you can do here, including run the ball, if you're North Carolina.
And what gets lost in this is Sean Williams almost suffered a sack.
5-yard sideline interference call against Baylor. Half the distance.
That always comes after a warning. We'll check in with Jerry Punch. Doc?
Yeah, Art Briles very, very angry over the helmet call. He was over with the head linesman talking to him. The head linesman walked away. Briles and the staff walked down to him. And then the flag came out for the sideline warning and the penalty.
All right, Jerry, thanks very much. Williams, nice head fake. Dives, touchdown, Tar Heels. Marquise Williams is taking this offense on his back. Trayvon Blanchard went for the fake, skied above Marquise Williams, who ran for the score. That's a gutsy run.
And a break because Sean Oakman had his helmet knocked off. That wasn't called, but because he continued on the play, got the personal foul. Terrific move. He really does have a nice feel. You can see that little shift to the right, gaining some position. The bigger guy at 225 pounds, good run.
Boy, the heels needed that. 28-17 makes it an 11-point ball game. Only took a minute and 41.
I know that Baylor can only run the ball, but 35 seconds seems like a lot of time to leave the way that they've been running the ball.
The Heels, by the way, will get the ball to start the second half. And Art Briles still barking. New Year's Eve, you can catch the college football playoff semifinals right here on ESPN. 4 Eastern, the Capital One Orange Bowl, number 4 Oklahoma, number 1 Clemson. And at 8 o'clock, number 3 Michigan State, number 2 Alabama in the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Both games on ESPN, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. And last year, Clemson just handed it to Oklahoma in the 2014 Russell Athletic Bowl.
And what's amazing is the improvement that Oklahoma made from this game forward. Of course, Lincoln Riley was brought in as the offense coordinator, and that was talked about a lot. But the defensive improvement Oklahoma has made, they were really struggling in their secondary at the end of last season. Didn't show up and play very well in this game at all against a backup quarterback in Chad Kelly. But that improvement, I think, has been the key.
Cliff Stout.
Yeah.
Did it all without Deshaun Watson.
Chad Kelly, of course, transferred to Ole Miss. Apologize for that.
So with 35 seconds to go, Baylor, and as much as they have run the ball out of the Wildcat or Wild Bear formation, if you will, They are not a real danger to get you a big play through the air. And look at this, 333 yards rushing. And as Art Brown said, we will always be able to run the football, even if you load the box, because you know they're only going to throw five passes a game. They've still shredded that defensive line.
And that breaks the record set by Illinois in 1999 against Virginia. They went for 325. And, oh, by the way, we're not into halftime yet.
Just a marvelous performance in the running game. You got to credit that offensive line. These guys are studs. And they're going to come out throwing, and they throw to Johnny Jefferson, the do-everything quarterback slash running back slash wide receiver.
And you still, even without Corey Coleman, you still have tons of speed on the outside. And Baylor, I think, a little confused there, wasn't sure how they were going to save some clock, but they needed to get the timeout because guys were walking around. But now you're in a position, you manage the clock, you're going to get at least one throw down the field into the end zone. But if you manage it even better and you pick up a few more throws like that, you're going to be in Chris Callahan territory, your kicker.
Pardon me, that was KD Cannon and not Jefferson on the reception. Well, they would love to think they could get close enough to get a shot at a field goal.
28 seconds left. You're looking at between three and five plays, depending on how long each one takes. So you've got plenty of time. You still have that one timeout. You don't want to get to a place where you're going to burn 10 or 12 seconds to get back to the line of scrimmage.
Chris Johnson is the quarterback. He has Chafe at number 28 in there with him as a running back. And Chafin will get the carry. Chafin down to the 37-yard line. They'll move the sticks.
And they're trying to get a play call in right now so they don't have to spike it and don't have to use a timeout. This should be good clock management by Baylor.
They'll wind the clock. Jefferson throws to the sideline. Cannon made the catch, gets out of bounds to stop the clock with 15 seconds to go. This looks like a veteran quarterback is running the two-minute drill. This is unbelievable.
And North Carolina is so afraid of getting beat over the top, everything underneath. And they're right on the kind of the range of their kicker, Callahan. He's not great. He hasn't hit from over 40 this year, 0 for 3. So they want to be down inside the 20, I think, before field goal. But right now, I promise you Art Briles and Kendall Briles and that whole offensive staff is thinking 6. Not 3.
And North Carolina takes a timeout. They want to set their defense. Baylor still has one, and there's 14 seconds on the clock, so you can throw it anywhere. And if you
can run it with that timeout.
Sure, yes, you could. And why not? You've already run 330-some yards in the first half.
Yeah, and they ran it for the first down there. But this has got to be just... This is mind-blowing how good Baylor has been on offense. If you haven't read or seen what happened, the Biletnikoff winner, the best receiver in the country, Corey Coleman, is out. He had sports hernia surgery. He's going to the NFL. Shaq Linwood, their top rusher the last 3 years, is out. He broke his foot against Texas. Both quarterbacks, both first and second string quarterback, Russell and Stidham, out. They've been doing nothing but
is
running
that
the ball. That's it. Oh, no, sorry, the right tackle, Pat Colbert, is out as well. But this offense, of course, one of the best in the country, was the best the last 3 years, but to manufacture with, and they couldn't move the ball for a little while against Texas, still trying to figure some things out, especially when Johnson was concussed. But they figured it out getting ready for the bowl game.
They're one of only three teams ever to average over 600 yards a game, and they might keep that. Quarterback draw with Jefferson. They will have to use that final timeout.
Yeah, and now you're looking at, you know you can get two plays off here. You know you can get two.
That was Chris Johnson.
So here you are. I think you maybe throw it to the end zone or throw something short. The problem is then you'd have to rush on the kicker. I don't think you want to do something where you're sprinting guys on hoping they get out before the ball is set and the clock stops. So I think you want to throw one into the end zone here, and then you're looking for a Callahan field goal.
He's only made 8 this year, 8 out of 12.
And both Bryle's father and son, talking about what they have to do once the play is done. The whole key here for your quarterback is almost got to be thinking ahead to, okay, what's happening? How do I manage getting the field goal unit out? Like I said, I think this would be a smart throw to the end zone.
It's got to be sideline or end zone.
Yeah.
You're out of timeouts.
I don't think you want anything where you're trusting that you're going to get your field goal unit on with the clock restarting.
No.
Johnson does throw it for the end zone and out of the end zone. So 3 seconds left. Now you'll bring on the field goal unit and try to make it a 2-touchdown spread.
And Callahan, the kicker for Baylor, has been terrific inside of 40, which this will end up being. He's 8-for-9 on the season, so been pretty automatic for them once they get inside of 40 yards.
From 37 yards out, pulled it. Yanked it left. About the only thing Baylor didn't do well on offense tonight. 94 plays with both teams combined, 624 first half yards, and 45 points.
And Art Briles is not happy. I think he's still upset about that helmet call when Oakman was called for a personal foul.
Let's go to Jerry Punch and Coach Briles.
Coach, we could tell a lot of frustration from you on the helmet call from Oakman late in the first half. Why?
I mean, I'd have it all said. I mean, you don't just run, your helmet flies off. You know, I mean, to us, the helmet's knocked off. And if he did keep playing, then it's offsetting penalties. That's all I'm saying.
Offensively, this doesn't look like a team that's missing top two quarterbacks and best running back and receiver. You know, what do you say about the play of your offense? Already a record in the first half.
Nothing right now. I mean, we got to play the second half, and we got to play better than we played the first half to win.
All right, Coach.
Thank you.
Coaches with great tunnel vision. You play with who's here, not who isn't. At the half, 28-17, we send you to Reese Davis for the Coke Zero halftime report. Reese.
Guys, I think you have to admire North Carolina's gutsy defensive strategy. Clearly, they are trying to let Baylor run until they get tired. More than 350 yards rushing in the
back to Capital One Bowl Mania.
Come on and dance with me. Throw your arms around me. I'll follow that fire in your eyes. Let's take it all right now. Before that phone goes out. Kiss me like there's no goodbye. Stone ain't rolling. Not much for the morning. I'll give you a warning. I've always been good at tonight.
Welcome back to the Russell Athletic Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. And Baylor in a stunner here in the Russell Athletic Bowl, leading North Carolina 28-17. And I don't know about you, partner. I'm just blown away by what Baylor's been able to do.
And they got to try it out at the end of the Texas game because Chris Johnson was knocked out in the first half with a concussion. So they were able to start working on it. But in the month they had with finals academically, all of the holidays, to be able to put together this type of plan. And these are plays that they run all the time, but almost to go exclusively to an inside or quarterback-based run game is really spectacular. North Carolina is missing their best interior defensive lineman in Naz Jones, out with a concussion, has not played all day, and this defensive front is starting to really wear down. That was a big drive for North Carolina at the end of the half. Lucky to get away without the field goal by Baylor once they drove down. So a little bit of momentum. And for Marquise Williams, he gets the ball back to start.
Aren't you surprised that North Carolina has not thrown caution to the wind and just made sure they can stop the run?
Well, that's what they're going to have to do. I think Gene Chizik and Larry Fedora and everybody at halftime, you're going to have to play a little more man-to-man on the outside. Just trust that your secondary can cover and get as many bodies around the line of scrimmage as possible.
Baylor to kick off. This is Mike Hughes on the return. Out to the 25. Cut down there. Marquise Williams 11 of 23 for 96 yards. Did most of his damage, however, in the big plays on the ground. 11 carries, 62 yards, and a touchdown. He missed his last five throws, by the way.
We haven't seen a whole bunch. Larry Fedora in the past has run a very fast offense. Not quite as fast this year. They've slowed down on purpose. But let's see if they start using a little more tempo to try to get some of these guys up front, Billings and Palmer, and these guys a little worn out for Baylor now.
They have gotten very little out of Elijah Hood, only 7 carries. This pass complete to Hollins, and Mac Hollins is off to the races. 75 yards for Hollins, his 9th touchdown grab of the year. This is a young man who has made big play after big play, averages 25.4 on the season.
Baylor had coverage. Baylor stopped on the play. Hollins just runs an out cut. Boy, that was just a bad safety position Orion Stewart. Stewart just came way up from his... He jumped an underneath route from his safety position. And Hollins is a guy...
He's out of bounds.
Holy cow. They're bringing this all the way back for his left foot being out of bounds on the 34-yard line. But they've put it on the 41. They've misspotted the ball by 6 yards. I wonder if anybody's picking this up. That was the 34-yard line. They brought it back to the 41. They missed by 5.
Boy, and the replay booth needed to see that one.
Yeah, they should have stopped that. It was the replay. Everyone saw that. We thought for the world it was a touchdown.
What a crushing disappointment, though.
Yeah. And a big break for Orion Stewart, the safety who took a bad angle from Baylor, that Hollins just upped out and then got the bonus 5 yards by the missed spot.
Yeah, he's telling his teammates that never happened. Don't worry about it. Hood gets a shove from Williams.
Well, he's right.
Takes it out to the 48. Yes, he is. Technically, right. He's right.
But, Coach, he stepped out of bounds.
Big third down here. The Heels have to shake it off. Hood on the toss. 2 defenders waiting for him. Nice job by Hood. Split the 2 Baylor defenders and powered his way to what should be a first down.
And Avion Edwards, who's played really well, got up extremely slow after this hit. He's still kind of wobbling around a little bit. Hood, 230 pounds. And Avion Edwards lowered down and got a big piece of that leg, and he was wobbly when he got up.
It took a knee right in the helmet. Marquise Williams down the middle, contact and a flag. And Bug Howard said, should be a flag. He turned around, it was already there. Xavier Howard looked like he was all over him in the middle of the field.
Pass interference. Defense number 4, 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Howard versus Howard. Bug, you mentioned given name Jonathan, doing a really nice job of making an effort to try to get out there and make the play. And it was decent position by Howard, but he was pushing through the back of the receiver and clearly interfered.
So the Heels take over from the 33. Nice fake by Williams. Down to the 28-yard line. Faked it to Switzer, trying to use his ability to run to make the linebackers go wide and leave Williams more running room up the middle.
Good job by North Carolina after Hollins' touchdown is called back because he was out of bounds, getting refocused and getting this drive going.
Williams short set goes to Davis. Quinshad Davis out of bounds at around the 13-yard line, his 4th catch. Here's Jerry Punch.
Yeah, quickly updating Brandon Fitz, a tight end that was injured in the first half. He's out for the game, concussion. And Ryan Switzer, who caught that pass a moment ago, suffered a laceration in and around his mouth late in the first half. That was addressed in the locker room. He obviously back in the ballgame playing tough.
That was when he took a shot down near the 1-yard line, the one that was originally called targeting. Williams under pressure, just throws a defender out of the way, dumps it underneath to Romar Morris. And Morris may have another first down, and Travion Blanchard missed him.
Boy, Blanchard had
the sack right there.
Sure did. And this is as North Carolina now going fast to the line of scrimmage. Blanchard went to play the ball instead of the man.
To about the two on first down.
And that was the smaller back in Logan. Expect maybe Elijah Hood, and here comes Hood, the 220-pounder. And, you know, without Fritz, as Duck Punch just mentioned, Fritz is a guy at 6'4 who plays in that slot. Wouldn't be expecting much throw here.
Hood has run for 17 touchdowns this year, but instead it's Marquise Williams who fakes it to the big guy and keeps it. So even though they had the big touchdown play called back because the receiver stepped out of bounds, they have enough poise to take it downfield and score, and they're within 4 points with the extra point.
Terrific answer. Good misdirection. Excellent block on the edge there by Kendrick Singleton. Good physical contact. His defender had to freeze, and a good read by Marquise Williams, the quarterback.
Weiler with the point after a 75-yard drive. 9 plays, 3 minutes and 15 seconds. The Heels right back in it.
Allstate might want to sponsor something like the three and out. We'll give money if you get three and outs instead of field goals and extra points.
They might not have to donate anything.
Not in today's game. Not with guys like Art Briles coaching. And Larry Fedora, for that matter.
Taken by Platt on the bounce across the 20. And takes it out of bounds to the 24. We go to the sideline and Jerry Punch. Doc?
Mike, I spoke with a very confident Larry Fedora coming out of the Tar Heel locker room at halftime and asked him specifically, what do you do to stop this Baylor offense? He said, you know, we've just got to tackle better. We've been in position. That was the focus in the locker room at halftime. We've got to come out and tackle better, which obviously we're going to see if the message hit home here in the Baylor's first offensive possession here in the third quarter.
Doc, you're absolutely right. And let's see how Carolina lines up on defense. With two deep safeties, two corners out wide.
No, they're not crowding the line of scrimmage.
Nope.
There's still two deep safeties. I mean, they're at 11. They're not super deep.
Chafin trying to get wide. Will pick up about five before Dominic Green forces him out of bounds.
That was when we were visiting with Gene Chizik, the new defensive coordinator. He spent the 2 years that he was away from the game visiting with a lot of NFL teams. And the two-deep safety look where the safeties help shut down any big plays is something that they've worked on.
Little swing to Chafin. Stuck as he got to the 33. Nice hit by M.J. Stewart, and Green assisted as well. Stewart to corner. Very physical. Can tackle, can blitz. Leads the nation in pass breakups. Not going to get many of those tonight. And they'll run for the first down. Chafin again. Young man who was hampered earlier in the season by injuries. Healthy now and contributing certainly in this game. Look at what they have done tonight. As they said, they are always going to be able to run the ball. But 370 in this game.
Yeah, and the pass game, of course, just almost completely gone.
This pass complete to Lee, and Jay Lee is into North Carolina territory for a first down. Malik Simmons couldn't contain him.
And Lee looks a little hobbled as he comes up. Of course, Corey Coleman, top receiver in the country, out. He decided to have sports hernia surgery and get ready for the NFL, leaving early. But Johnson able to throw that little hitch out to the side. We saw that at the end of the half, maybe getting a little confidence in that part of the throw game.
Jefferson lost his footing and went down. Justin Thomason helped him to the ground. He's this big number 98, the nose man with 3.5 sacks.
And he's in there playing almost every down now with Jalen Dalton playing next to him.
Jefferson spins his way down to the 37-yard line. Donnie Miles came up from his safety spot.
And for North Carolina, without Nas Jones, they've had to play almost the entire the defensive inside, the interior linemen have played almost every snap. You can see the helmet paint that Thomason is starting to gain on that helmet. They have just been in a battle.
Chris Johnson. Now, the fans are calling for a horse collar, but the tackler, Jalen Dalton, obviously had it just below.
Well, the other
would get called for a horse.
The other thing too is you have to pull the runner down in the immediate action, and in that time, Dalton was riding his back, didn't yank him down either.
Baylor just continues to say, "Listen, we're going to run the football. Here we are. You try and stop it."
Well, you're right. He didn't quite have the horse collar, but he also didn't yank him down. He didn't have inside the collar, but he also didn't yank him down, and also between the tackle boxes. That's not a call that's made either.
Williams. And Ed, just as a football player plays the line, how demoralizing is this for North Carolina? And how invigorating is this for Baylor?
It's starting to become like Baylor's offensive line. It's starting to feel like practice because the defense is getting so tired. They don't have the sting. They don't have the pop with their hands. You're able to grab a hold and they can't get away. So this is starting to feel a bit like a spring practice.
Chafin on the direct snap. Taken out of bounds short of the 10.
And I'm not knocking North Carolina. This is a defense that played so much better all year than they did last year. Just with Nas Jones down, Gene Chizik, the defensive coordinator, and all the new defensive staff, they're running out of big bodies. And the offensive line for Baylor has been and was coming into the season. They knew that this was going to be a group, the best group, by far, that Art Briles has had in his time at Baylor, and it's starting to pay off.
Chafin on a little swing. Well, you look at that offensive line. Drango, the left tackle, the Big 12 offensive lineman of the year. Blake Muir, the left guard, first team All-Big 12. Kyle Fuller, the center, second team All-Big 12. And Jarrell Braxton made first and second team All-Big 12 selections this year. That's four all-conference guys in the line. Johnson, there's that jump pass, and it's picked off. You said we would see it again. And it was picked off by Dominique Green, his second interception of the year, and a clutch play at the goal line.
Green, who's filling in for Sam Smiley, the starting safety who was lost against NC State, reads this perfectly. That's a touchdown. If Dominic Green doesn't step in front of it, and all of a sudden, North Carolina making this very interesting.
against Wisconsin in the National Funding Holiday Bowl. Both games also streaming on ESPN. Hood keeps his balance across the 15.
Give a lot of credit to North Carolina. There in that second quarter, it looked like they were about to get run out of this building.
Absolutely.
And to hang in there, get some offense going. We mentioned that Seth Luttrell, the normal play caller, not here. He's off to North Texas to be the head coach. So we're taking it over by committee, although Keith Heckendorf, the quarterback coach upstairs, is technically calling the plays tonight.
Williams with a swing to Prohl, and Austin Prohl up near the 20. There is a flag down at the end of the play. Trayvon Blanchard was out there. Second team all Big 12 linebacker to make the stop. We'll check out the penalty. Prohl, Austin Prohl right in the middle. He says, I'll listen in as long as we're discussing this.
If he's anything like his dad, Ricky, he had a joke to tell and wanted to get it out. Lighten the mood. His dad Ricky was a teammate of mine in the NFL, one of the best teammates I ever had. His dad was a great player and a
personal
good guy.
Foul. Targeting. Offense number 13. That ruling is under further review.
That call is going against Mac Hollins.
And the targeting you see from an offensive player is almost always the lowering of the head, hitting with the crown of the helmet. Targeting is not exclusive to defensive players. And that's targeting.
Yep.
That is absolutely targeting. It is
that
defenseless.
Fits all the parameters, doesn't it?
Well, it's a defenseless player. His head is turned. There is forcible contact to the head or neck area. Hollins targets, meaning he goes into the hit to lower the block. And here's what's tough is, as Doug Rhodes comes in and helps us, if this stands, and I think it will, the one earlier in Reed for Baylor I thought should be overturned, this one should stand. Hollins, who's a big play receiver, over 25 yards per catch, he'll be ejected. And that's a big loss when you're down four for North Carolina.
Yeah, he was the guy who had the 75-yard touchdown play called back because he had stepped out of bounds. Doug, this looks pretty clear-cut, doesn't it?
Right. One of the nine enumerated defenseless players is a player who receives a blindside block. And it doesn't say offense, defense, but if it's a blindside block, you cannot hit them in the head or neck area. And so when it comes from the blind side there, what replay will have to ascertain if it was in the head or neck area. It doesn't matter whether it's with a helmet, arm, shoulder, hand, anything.
No question.
Blind side block.
No question in the replay that's forcible to the head or neck area.
To the head or neck area.
Plus, it looked like it was even the crown of the helmet, so he got the trifecta.
you could have everything.
Yeah. They can only eject him once, though. So
that's correct.
That's the good news for North Carolina. The bad news is you lose a guy who's a terrific player. You mentioned 25 yards per catch. He's a good long threat. But good job by this Big Ten officiating crew. Of course, we get mixed crews for these games sometimes, and that was a wonderful call. You don't see it a lot called on offensive players, but this is a situation where the rule is in for all players, not just defense against offense, but all players. And the reason you get a Big Ten crew is you have an ACC team and a Big 12 team, and so they're hoping for impartiality is why they bring a Big Ten crew in to work a game. The crew is not mixed with different officials from the Big Ten. It's the same crew that's worked together, but it's a Big Ten crew coming in to work an ACC and Big 12 game.
Here's the call.
After further review, the ruling on the field of targeting stands. As a result, number 13 is disqualified. Penalty will be half the distance to the goal. Second down.
So that's a big loss because of his big play ability.
And again, it's a blindside block, as Doug Rhodes was telling us, so it's a defenseless player and a well called. That is what we are trying to get out of the game. Those are the dangerous hits. Those are the ones that are causing concussions, causing injuries that we need to start addressing with rules like this and better technique and equipment and all those things. But Hollins now trying to get the North Carolina fans fired up a bit as he takes it to the dressing room.
Of course, North Carolina fans and the coaching staff didn't like the call, but if they go back and take a look at that replay, I don't see any other call you can make.
Well, the good news for Hollins, he's a junior. He'll be back. This is not his final walk-off of the field. speaking of returners, this offense will return a lot of players, and Mitch Trubisky, the backup quarterback, looks like the real deal. So this offense may actually get better.
Doesn't
next
he
season.
Ever?
Yeah.
Hood got rid of the first tackler, still driving for yardage. Makes it out to the 12. It'll be third and long.
Remember that North Carolina can run the ball too, and we've seen how North Carolina's defensive line has gotten worn out. Well, now you're starting to get some of these big bodies. Billings there in the middle. Jamal Palmer, these guys are going to be having to slow down a 220-pound power back and a 225-pound good running quarterback. So maybe the energy starts to switch over to North Carolina.
Check the yardage here. We're calling a 3rd and 7. Williams under pressure, and down he goes back at the 7-yard line. The sack from Taylor Young, his 4th of the season. The sophomore who's been slowed by a shoulder injury, and for one of the few times today, they get to Marquise Williams.
Out here on the outside. Goes inside the tackle, and the running back dropped his head. And Young, a guy who looks like he has a really nice feel. 5'10", 225. And Hood, the running back, you almost have to catch the guy with your face. I know that sounds crazy, but you literally let him run into your face and you grab him. That time Hood leaned forward. Young was nice and slippery.
Joey Mangili punts to Lynx Hawthorne, and the Baylor defense has something to cheer about. Now there is a flag down after the play, some pushing and shoving after the fair catch. And we'll check out this marker. It was a very short kick.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Receiving team, number 13, 15 yards from the spot of the foul. First down, Baylor. Timeout.
We'll show you the unsportsmanlike conduct call. Little push at the end. That's it. Back in a moment.
The semifinals are on New Year's Eve. So there probably are some college football fans who have to go to a dinner or have to go to a place that may not have the game on. So get the app and you won't miss the semis.
They come out throwing and get the ball into Carolina territory as Lee makes the grab. Johnson seems to like to throw to his left. He's been very accurate going to that side.
Well, he was a quarterback, and he lost the second-string job to Jarrett Stidham. So he moved to wide receiver, and then when Seth Russell went down, moved back to quarterback. So he was – you don't get recruited to Baylor as a quarterback, not at this part of Art Briles' process.
No.
If you can't throw it. So even though this – really is, and there's Seth Russell there. You can see he broke a bone in his neck. And there's Stidham. Broke a bone in his foot against Oklahoma State. Was hurt against Oklahoma. Hurt his back early in that game. Finished it out. And then was playing really well against Oklahoma State. Broke his foot, and then Chris Johnson had to take over. They ended up winning that game and then stumbled home without a starting quarterback.
Russell and Coleman were quite the combination. Coleman had 20 touchdown catches. Russell threw for 29. They were virtually unstoppable as Baylor was averaging 61 points a game when they were both healthy.
Yeah, it was starting to look like Baylor had a video game type of team earlier in the year. And I think if Russell, as well as he was playing, and some of the pieces they have, if Coleman stayed healthy, I think this was a playoff caliber team for sure.
Johnson under pressure. Tries to make a back shoulder throw, and that is going to be an interference call against Dez Lawrence. He didn't like the call. It was intended for Cannon, and he and Lawrence are wolfing at each other.
15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
Well, Dez Lawrence had terrific position on Cannon. He's got to just turn and find that ball just a second earlier, but you can see that right hand if he... He's got great position. If that right hand doesn't pull the left arm, it's a good call. I think that was clearly pass interference. But not playing the ball is why you get called there. And if Lawrence is able to turn just a half a second earlier, and see the ball, and you can see these two guys still jawing at each other.
Well, that's the problem with that trail technique. If you turn a half a second late, you don't know where it is.
Cannon picked it up first and made his body position ready for the ball, and Lawrence knocked it.
So big break all the way down to the 26, and they'll hand it off to Chafin. Chafin turns the corner, picks up 11, 12 yards before he's forced out of bounds. So they've used Chafin, Jefferson, and Williams at running back, Johnson and Hawthorne and the three running backs as guys who are getting direct snaps.
And now they've got a flag, and the way the North Carolina defense is clapping, this looks like it's going to be against Baylor.
After the play was over, unsportsmanlike conduct, offense number 9, 15 yards from the end of the run, first down, that is number 9's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul.
Guys have to find a way to keep their emotions in check.
And he's been going toe-to-toe there. And they went. It's got to be something he said. Yeah, it's got to be something that he said.
Doc, did you see anything down there?
Yeah, the official told him to quit talking. He turned back to the official and said something right to the side judge's face. And he pulled the flag. So it's obviously a comment he didn't like.
And, Jerry, he was... Everybody was walking back. There would not have been a penalty if he wasn't determined that he was going to be selfish and some comment that he shouldn't have.
And the reason the referee marks and says it's his first personal foul, you get two now, you're ejected. So for KD Cannon, when he's told not to say anything for the rest of the game, he may want to listen to that next time.
The only good thing about that penalty is they gave them the first down. Then the penalty is marked off, so it's not first and 25, still first and 10.
Well, that would be just cruel and unusual.
Just trying to point it out.
No, fair point.
Chris Johnson looks right, goes up the middle. With the troubles they have had with longer field goals, this could be interesting.
Yeah, you're right on the edge. You're inside of Callahan, the kicker's range, but they've been going for it a lot on fourth down, and you're in a position, even if you pick up a yard or two, don't be surprised if Baylor goes for it on fourth.
Third and four. Chafin cuts it outside. First down and more. Chafin still on his feet inside the 5 to the 3.
And an excellent job by KD Cannon. Cannon's been out there jawing it up with Lawrence. But look at Cannon with his hands inside. Lawrence does a nice job fighting off and finally making the tackle. But Cannon's right there to tell him,
I did
a nice job blocking you.
Yeah.
Cannon needs to be careful. If he gets caught one more time, and a lot of times it's swear words. The officials don't want to hear guys cursing at each other. He's got to be careful.
To the goal line, and Williams touchdown. Must have just gotten the point of the ball over the line.
Well, the one thing you notice when you're watching Terrence Williams, he's long, very long arm, 6'2", and does a wonderful job of fighting to get across. Does not look from that angle like any part of his body is down, but that was a terrific finish by Williams. He's a smooth, good runner. They've used him a lot. He has a good feel for the direct snap, and that time, nice second effort. And here goes Baylor again.
You can say just what you did about him about four or five other guys. It's been a real show to see that Baylor, which has had 95% of their passing game taken away from them because of injuries, just being able to say, okay, we can't pass, we'll run it. Take a look at the hot topics around college football, brought to you by Outback Steakhouse. Boise held Northern Iowa to 31 total yards. Duke and Indiana, what else would it be but an offensive shootout between those two? And Virginia Tech and Tulsa, 76 in the first half. And Frank Beamer completes an exceptional career with the Hokies.
And you know who spoiled Frank Beamer's home finale? These Tar Heels. Beat him in overtime. And Frank Beamer's last game, Larry Fedora actually was the one who called a fade to Quinshon Davis. Quinshon Davis in overtime that beat Beamer, kept obviously an unbeaten ACC Coastal run alive for Larry Fedora. And for North Carolina, the first time in the history of the school that they ran off 11 straight wins in the same season. So just a miraculous run after a tough start against South Carolina.
And Larry Fedora, because of that great streak, had his contract extended by 4 years. So great news for him and his coaching staff. Yeah. Give them some stability. We've seen it all over the country. Yeah. If you don't have stability on your coaching staff, it's very, very difficult to win.
Well, they got a good one. Bubba Cunningham, the athletic director, came in 4 years ago, picked up a little bit of a mess with some of the academic issues that were uncovered at North Carolina, still dealing with that. All of that, of course, under the previous administration and not under this coaching staff. So, as usual, the people left behind left to do what they can. And Larry Fedora has done an amazing job through a change of staff,
really
through some NCAA investigations that, frankly, are still ongoing, but they expect to turn out okay. But Fedora has been nothing but positive in growing this program.
Aerial coverage today and tonight brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you've got to get DirecTV.
I'm telling you that blimp is fake. There's no way that's real.
You could be right.
It might be computer graphics.
Not sure. Straight up the middle goes Hood. Still on his feet looking for a block. Now it's a foot race. Elijah Hood to the 8-yard line. With the skill players they have, they are never out of a ball game.
I know we're still in this game and Baylor's playing great, but North Carolina is so impressive to me, and they return, I believe, as many as 20 starters for next year's team. Florida State's going to be really good. Clemson's going to be really good. I think North Carolina next season, those three teams, one of those teams is winning the championship. Don't be surprised if it's these guys.
Williams. Hands it off to Logan. Logan fighting for yardage, gets inside the three. And this what a great run that was by Hood. 67 yards.
And we've been talking about the offensive line for Baylor. How about this front for North Carolina? It's been a huge improvement under Fedora.
Logan again. Fumble! It's recovered by Baylor. Avion Edwards, who has had a monster game, made the hit. Now, the only question would be, did he get to the goal line first? It doesn't look like it. The official's still talking about it.
Well, you got the smaller back in Logan. Hood, I would imagine, may be a little tired after that long run. Ball's out. Boy, what a nice tackle by Edwards. That type of tackle, frankly, on the goal line shouldn't cause a fumble. That ball should be tucked away, but just good job. You mentioned the game that Edwards is having, but what an unbelievable turn of events.
That's all of a sudden, backbreaker.
Yeah, you're down 11. You're going into score to cut it to four or less, and you give the ball right back. And here's the problem. You put the defensive line back out there that is just... Yes. Great push. Looks like he's going to slide in for a touchdown. No doubt that Edwards knocked that ball loose.
That's a heartbreaker for Carolina, especially after Hood's exceptional run to set it up.
Carolina fans need to relax. We're still in the third quarter here. There's going to be, you figure, between four and six more possessions for your offense. So you're going to have plenty of chances.
And because the ball was fumbled into the end zone instead of at the six-inch line, they have it at the 20 instead of under the shadow of their own goalpost.
Well, we showed earlier that Baylor's defense, one of the best in the country at knocking it free. Phil Bennett starting to get the type of athletes that, I haven't covered Baylor, and I think it's been about six seasons. It's really impressive the type of player, the size athletes they've been able to get. This is a completely changed program from when Art Briles took over.
Nice fake by Johnny Jefferson. Look at that speed. Jefferson. Still on his feet. Touchdown. 80 yards for Johnny Jefferson. And if you thought the fumble was a backbreaker, that one certainly is. Who needs a quarterback? Johnny Jefferson, 259 yards rushing. That's 259. The team has rushed for 535. That's insane.
This is an offense that's averaging just over 600 yards a game because they average 300 pass, 300 run. They're going to get 600 yards rushing today.
Yes, they are.
Well more. I mean, we're not even into the fourth quarter yet. And even if they get ahead enough where they have to run the ball to run out the clock, the way this defense is worn out, I'm not sure they're not going to take a few more to the house.
The fumble set it up.
So everybody is going to read the fake. Jefferson doing a wonderful job taking the direct snap. Everybody goes the wrong way. A good block down the field. And then MJ Stewart, who walks down Jefferson, watch this, goes for the ball instead of the tackle. If he makes the tackle, it would be first and goal on about the 8-yard line, which is a tough down and distance. I know Stewart's trying to make a good play here, but this is a teaching moment for a young player, just a sophomore. Go in, sweep the legs, get the guy down at the 7-yard line, and let's play some more defense.
Jawan Drennan, number 17, the defensive end, made the cardinal error. You cannot fire inside. You have to keep the corner, keep leverage. He didn't.
How about the difference between those two sidelines? You got the Baylor team faking like they're the marching band, and North Carolina wondering what in the world's going on.
And they'll start at the 25. Couple of bowl records for Jefferson now. 259 yards is the big one. That one may stand for a long, long time.
You know what's amazing for Jefferson? He came into this game with 700 yards rushing. He could leave with 1,000. Can you imagine that? Coming into a bowl game with 700 yards and leaving as a 1,000-yard rusher on the season. And, oh, by the way, Shock Linwood, the guy who was the starter, had 1,300-plus yards. The guy's averaging almost 18 yards a carry. That's a pretty good average.
That's just stunning.
You know, you go back to Mac Hollins being ejected. Now you're down 42-24. How much would it help to have a guy who's averaging 25 yards a catch, but he's been ejected for targeting?
Bug Howard is another big play guy, averaging over 17. He was the intended receiver on this one. And Larry Fedora, appealing to the official, wanted an interference call there and didn't get it. This is a big-time offense. They're not out of it. There comes Hood. He'll have a first down. Elijah Hood, who rushed for 1,345 yards during the regular season.
Well, there's only one tempo you can go right now if you're North Carolina, and that's that play clock and, of course, the game clock are the mark of how fast you can go. They change personnel, so Baylor gets a chance to match up on defense.
Williams throws underneath to Singleton. Now, here's the thing. North Carolina's down 3 scores, but you can't assume they will stop Baylor from scoring any more points the rest of the game either.
I think if you're North Carolina, you got to go fast, you got to score, and then I think you got to start thinking of onside kicks almost right away. Because whether you give them the ball or the 50 or their own 20, it's been about the same.
Williams to Switzer down near the 40. Of course, Baylor doesn't mind the shorter games. They just don't want to give up the bombs.
This is really something. To see Baylor, who really just had their hearts and everything ripped away from them with two quarterbacks getting hurt. They may have been the best team in the country. But to see them to scrap together an effort like this against a good opponent in a bowl game.
That's Romar Morris. Well, Ed, to further your point, they lost 3 of the last 4 games after they lost all these skill players. They had to be at a psychological low, but Art Briles isn't going to put up with that. He found a way to motivate these kids, to tell them, you have the ability to do this, let's go get them. for the end zone touchdown. Bug Howard comes through on the outside. And Marquise Williams, you got to hand it to him. He is doing everything he possibly can to bring him back.
Pretty good coverage here by Howard. He even got around. Little hands on the back. You could see Howard there, and it is impossible for the official. He can't see through the receiver. So if the receiver's hands are down, he gets a little bit of a push there. That's good technique. If the official saw it, he may be able to call it, but because his body, the receiver's body, is between the official and the defender, Howard gets away with, if you saw those hands, they were down low on the hip. That's the best way to move someone out of the way, is on their hips.
Two teams have now combined for more than 1,000 yards in offense, and we've got a full quarter to go.
We might end up with 1,000 yards rushing before this is over.
Following our game tonight, Capital One Bowl Mania rolls on. The Advocare V100 Texas Bowl, Leonard Fournette, number 20 LSU, up against Texas Tech. That's up next on ESPN, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app. Love Leonard Fournette. What a monster of a running back. 158 yards a game.
It's a guy who was a little misused at the end. They started running the ball sideways a bit. It'll be interesting to see if they take Fournette at about 240, run him straight at Texas Tech. That's not the Red Raiders' strength, stopping the run. So you'd expect maybe 300 yards rushing or more for LSU tonight.
Well, if you're an optimist, North Carolina is back within a field goal, a touchdown, and a two-point conversion. So, for them, a two-point or a two-possession ball game. But they've got to find a way to stop Baylor.
I'm not sure you don't sneak it onside here. Okay, maybe not.
Now kick it out of bounds. Here's Jerry Punch.
Just got to remember back to the ACC title game in North Carolina against top-ranked Clemson. North Carolina couldn't stop Clemson offensively. Sound familiar? Clemson earned over 608 yards of total offense. North Carolina was down twice by 19 points to top-ranked Clemson in that ballgame and came back with 73 seconds to play and had a shot to send it into overtime. This team has played awful well and hasn't given up much all year long.
All right, Doc, tonight they are giving up record yards to Johnny Jefferson and company. Jefferson has 259, the team, 535 rushing. That's right, rushing. Stunning. Chafin, going to add to that total, picks up six more. Good stop by M.J. Stewart. Solid tackle on the outside. Wouldn't let Chafin get any more.
Well, watch the left guard. This is Blake Blackmar, redshirt freshman who's been playing a ton. Just drives the nose guard, Thomason, completely out of the way. And that's what we've been seeing all night. Blackmar, a young man who's been playing quite a bit as a redshirt freshman. Pat Colbert, the tackle, has been out with a shoulder injury. So some of these younger guys getting some run. But Blackmar is a guy who... They expect big things out of, and the ability and linemen that Baylor have been able to start getting. You knew when Art Briles got to Baylor from Houston, they were going to be able to throw it and get some good skill players. But he's starting to build offensive linemen that go play in the NFL. Six of the last drafts have had six Baylor offensive linemen in them.
Well, there will be another one this year with Drango. He is the real deal. End of the third quarter. It's a two-possession game in Orlando. And that'll get him five more to Terrence Williams. We'll see Johnny Jefferson get the ball to see if he can get that that magic 300-yard rushing game get to 1,000. Wouldn't that be something?
Yep.
Crazy formation here. Blake Muir, the guard, moves out to the outside.
You got four guys to one side of the field. They come back, throw to the other, and they've got a first down as they hit the tight end, Gus Penning.
Penning, a terrific story. He moved up when Trevon Armstead, the starter, was dismissed from the team early in the year. Junior college transfer. First junior college team he went to, they canceled football. He thought his career was over.
Johnson with a run.
But Penning, the tight end, originally from the state of Michigan. He went to junior college there. They canceled the football program. He went out to California, played 1 year of junior college there. 6'5", 250 senior, runs and catches well. And Art Briles thinks when the NFL teams come in and start testing our seniors, he thinks Penning's going to grade out very well and get a shot.
It's like the old Rich Rodriguez story when he was at Salem and he said, your day doesn't start off too well, when the athletic director said, we just folded the program. Down to the 31-yard line goes Chafin.
Well, the funny part for Penning, before they canceled the program, he had redshirted. So he didn't even play the season before they canceled. So he was a guy thinking his college career was over with 1 year of not playing.
Chafin again. Carolina desperately needs a stop.
Worn out is what they are up front for North Carolina. And I'm just not sure that North Carolina is going to be able to make the same comeback they did against Clemson in the ACC championship game. But you cannot knock the effort of these young men. This is a team that finished 6-7. They had some infighting. Dr. Punch talked about how Larry Fedora brought everybody in. They cleared the air, got an entirely new defensive staff. And again, this game notwithstanding, they ran into just a crazy good Baylor offense.
There goes Jefferson. And with McGowan at the tight end on the left side.
And without their best defensive lineman. And you say, okay, it's just one guy. But that's a guy, Naz Jones, that you can rotate through, keep bodies a little fresh. And I think that Larry Fedora, you mentioned the contract extension. He got seven new years right before the ACC championship game. And they've got the right guy.
And right now you have defenders who aren't even going to the ground on tackles. They just can't. They physically can't do it. Jefferson again lowers his shoulder, very close to a first down.
And you can tell Baylor, they are almost always super fast. They average over 80 plays a game. But you can tell that they're starting to slow down, let 10, 15 more seconds go off the clock. They're owning the line of scrimmage, so they don't have to go fast. And that was play number 84. And I've been watching Justin Thomason, a 300-pound nose guard. I have not seen on meaningful downs, I have not seen number 98 not in the game. So you think that guy has defended close to 80 plays and how tired he has to be.
Jefferson now is up to 269 yards as Terrence Williams moves over for Hawthorne, and Hawthorne on the keeper. Links Hawthorne inside the five, fighting for extra yards to the one. 6 feet, 205.
And there is just no energy left. Just no energy. That's Thomason there getting wrapped up by Blackmar. Blackmar looks like a pretty good lineman. He's a guy who's playing quite a bit more as the season wore on, but it looks like he might be the real deal.
And it's Terrence Williams, touchdown Baylor. Boy, they just keep coming. And you've got a feel for the Tar Heels. The spirit is there, but they're shot.
Yeah, Jeff Schottmer, the middle linebacker, just doesn't have enough to make the tackle. Let's watch Spencer Drango, though. He came up a little gimpy after the end of that. He's the fine left tackle, but I'd be surprised if we don't start seeing some fresh bodies, new numbers coming in there on offense next time Baylor gets the ball.
Baylor has now rushed for an astounding 597 yards. 597.
ESPN, home of the New Year's Six and the College Football Playoff.
The regular season has tested, eliminated, and ultimately chosen the four surviving teams for the College Football Playoff.
Touchdown, MSU!
Four teams, four chances, one champion. The College Football Playoff on ESPN.
Some very interesting matchups there. Clemson, an underdog against Oklahoma. Michigan State, the underdog against Alabama. There's the trophy for the winner here in the Russell Athletic Bowl. Right now, you've got to say Baylor has a big edge.
Well, but the good news for both of these teams, as we know from last year's Russell Athletic Bowl, Clemson and Oklahoma played in that game. And after you play in the Russell Athletic, you're guaranteed to get into the College Football Playoff the next year. That's a deal.
Is that?
The Russell Athletic Bowl. Well, it's one of the deals they set up when they got this game.
Okay.
They guarantee the teams that play that they'll be in the championship run next season. You know what's crazy? Both of these teams could be in the championship
good
run.
Good point.
I know Oklahoma, North Carolina, I think it's going to be Florida State, Clemson, North Carolina. Those will be the top three going to the ACC. I think in the Big 12 preseason, it'll clearly be Oklahoma with what they have coming back. But if you look at Baylor and who they have coming back, the lines have to be redone, and that's going to be the big deal. Offensive linemen, three or four defensive linemen, and maybe Billings, depending on the NFL grade he gets, may leave. So big deal there, but they will clearly have Seth Russell back. It looks like Shaq Linwood will come back. He wants a shot at breaking the Baylor all-time rushing record. So they'll be explosive.
I'm just fascinated by Jefferson, what he's doing tonight.
Yeah, Linwood may have a hard time getting the record next year because he's going to have to share some carries after both Jefferson and Terrence Williams and Chafin, all of those guys coming back as well.
Offensively, North Carolina has the ability to get the three touchdowns they need. The question is, how do they stop Baylor? Williams? Boy, he's taken a lot of hits tonight, hasn't he?
Yes, he has.
Courageous performance on his part. They only had the one big breakout run by Hood, and that was called back.
Well, and if you want to win here, even if you don't get the first, as crazy as it sounds, you got to start thinking about fourth downs.
Pressure coming. Williams throws underneath. Complete to Quinshad Davis, number two all-time in yards at North Carolina, number one in catches and receiving touchdowns. Ryan Reed was right there.
That's Mitch Trubisky. He's the guy I've been talking about all night. Played quite a bit this year, completed 85% of his passes. Very fast, maybe not as elusive as Williams, but this guy looks like the real deal. The coaches, the players, they return nine other starters on offense. Except the only guy they lose on the outside is Davis, but I think this is going to be an even better offense next year. Trubisky looks like he's a very good quarterback.
Mangili will punt it away. Fair catch signal for and made the punt 48 yards. Carolina running out of time. 9:03 left to go from Orlando.
proud presenting sponsor of the Buffalo Wild Wings Citrus Bowl.
49-31. Baylor DirecTV takes you inside the drive as we take a look at that last touchdown.
Well, it's been about the, what are we calling it, the Bearcat? Is that what we're calling the direct snap tonight?
Why not?
That Johnny Jefferson has put on a show. Baylor very close to 600 rushing yards. This is an offense that averaged over 600 yards per game, but that was half and half, 300 pass, 300 rush. And they come into this game without Seth Russell, without Jarrett Stidham, the first and second string quarterback, without Shaq Linwood, their leading rusher. And all Jefferson has done is crept towards 1,000 yards on the season. He came into the game with 701.
They may not be, even be aware on the sideline. You don't expect a guy to get 300 yards.
Yeah, well.
But he has 269 yards in this game. Add to it. Up to the 32. And they have gone as a team over 600 yards rushing in this game. That's the most ever. Broke Nebraska's record. Crushed it, in fact, all the way back to the 96 Fiesta Bowl. But 608 yards rushing when the defense knows you're going to run.
Every time. Yeah, it hasn't been a mystery. Of course, Nebraska running up and down the field on Florida. That was a mismatch. This one, not as much of a mismatch, though. I was at that game, and Nebraska was just so much better physically than Florida in that game. But this has been about scheme. This has been about pace. North Carolina, with down their best defensive interior lineman, they're having to defend. I believe they're into 90 snaps that they've had to defend. And for Gene Chizik and his defensive staff in their first year, I think they're ready to shut the season down. They don't want to see a whole bunch more of this Baylor group.
Jefferson at 285. Just from a history standpoint, I'd love to see the kid get 300, wouldn't you?
Yeah. That would give Baylor 2,000-yard rushers on the season. He would join Shaq Linwood, who's at 1,329.
Against Texas, he had, in the last game, 158. So he's had two pretty good back-to-back games.
Oh, well, bummer for him. Let's hope he's okay. You don't want
gimpy.
Yeah, you don't want to. He's a sophomore. You don't want to have this thing end. Just hope it's a little bump. But we also saw Jefferson's got a pretty good arm.
Yes, he does.
Maybe they just don't play a quarterback anymore at Baylor. Just play all running backs. You think Art Briles would go for something like that?
No. No, but he knows where he can go if he needs to.
Yeah. Briles, of course, was a head coach and athletic director in Texas high school football from 1984 until 1999. And we've talked a lot with Briles about his time at Texas, and a great relationship that started with Larry Fedora. Fedora was also a Texas high school coach, and when Fedora took his first college job, it was at Baylor. Fedora's recruiting area was back in Stephenville, Texas, where Art Briles was the coach, and Fedora would go as much as the NCAA would allow him to go visit a high school campus. He would, not just to recruit the players, but he was so impressed with what Briles did, watching his practice, how the tempo went. And so this is a neat relationship. Larry Fedora has known Art Briles for years. From the first time that Fedora went from the college ranks, he became an assistant under Grant Taff at Baylor. And as you know, the coaching circles, Larry Fedora spent 6 years at Baylor. It's the longest he's ever stayed anywhere. His first two kids were born there, so he's got a great connection to Waco and a tremendous amount of respect for Briles and what he did. And if you're in our business and you get a chance to go out and watch an Art Briles practice, it's one of the coolest things you can watch. When he was at Houston, we did one of his bowl games before he was hired at Baylor. I've never seen that much offense run in a practice. It goes so fast.
Extremely organized.
Yeah, and he's so fit and he's so positive. He's just in the middle of all of it. Think of all the stuff they had to adjust.
Williams will get another first down. They'll keep the clock running.
But if you look at the offense that Baylor ran in October with Seth Russell and then Jarrett Stidham to now, completely different. They had all of these elements. They had Wildcat. They have all of these inside run block schemes.
And so they rushed for over 300 yards.
Yeah, so it's not a totally new offense, but to readjust and focused almost exclusively. There's a look at Seth Russell, who is supposed to be completely fine after the broken bone in his neck was fixed surgically. Jared Stidham, who's still, they were thinking maybe he could be ready to start practicing again for the bowl, but was not able to. But to stitch together this offense is pretty awesome.
Williams again, and Donnie Miles right at the line of scrimmage makes the tackle. Let's go to Jerry Punch. Doc?
Yeah, I had a chance to visit with Seth Russell. What a nice young man. What a well-spoken young man prior to the game. And he told me he had surgery on his neck, both the front and back. And he's recovering nicely. He's got another check. He's got to pass early in February, hoping that things are healing well enough in February. And he gets news that he will not need more surgery, and he can return possibly to spring basketball.
Boy, look at that scar, Jerry. That's
And you could see the one on the front, too. Yeah. There was a broken bone they needed to stabilize in there. And you can see he's still having a little trouble turning that head. Here's
a great statistic for you. Baylor has now run 94 plays. 93 have been for plus yards. One time they've been stopped behind the line of scrimmage.
And there's that run. It was near the end. The game was close, so he's still in. But if there's anything you learn, we have got to get the head out of the game. Both offensive and defensive players, we've seen a little bit of that tonight. But Russell just running the ball and lowering that head and pays the price. And let's hope that if he is healthy and able to come back, learns to play with those eyes up, not the head down.
Got a timeout, 4:06 left. Tonight's Capital One Player of the Game. Very richly deserved, Johnny Jefferson. 289 rushing yards. It's not a misprint. He actually ran for 289 yards on 20 carries, caught another pass for 24, or threw a pass for 24. So he counted for 313 yards in total offense. It's just amazing.
And he still got his gear on, so even though he's a little gimpy after that last run, let's hope that he's okay.
Direct snap and the run by Terrence Williams.
You got to suspect that Baylor will go for it here on fourth down. Keep this clock running. What an amazing night for Johnny Jefferson, though, we were talking about. He's a guy who came into the game with 701 rushing yards. And I don't know if he's going to get any more run after coming off gimpy, but how close he got to 1,000 yards he needs.
Amazing.
Yeah. He needs 10 more yards rushing to break 1,000 for the season. But
now,
it
he
looked
might
like...
know, but I'm not sure anybody else down there knows. Because you can't say, going into the game, well, if you only get 299 yards, you'll be up to 1,000. That's not going to cross anybody's mind. Got another timeout. 3:21 to go. We'll see what they do on 4th and 2 when we come back.
In the bowl game.
Doug, thanks very much. Well, the glow faded from the rose in a hurry, didn't it?
Well, and there's probably a lot of athletic directors, because there's no doubt Chip Kelly can coach at the college level.
Yes.
But all the jobs being sewn up, probably a couple people wishing that Philly would have fired him earlier.
The offense certainly doesn't have the same impact as in the NFL as it does in college. Chafin, quarterback keeper, and he'll be stopped short of the first down. MJ Stewart came flying up from his corner spot to make a tackle, and you got to hand it to the Tar Heel, fighting to the end here. And they're congratulated by their teammates for making that stop. You can tune into ESPN3 for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One immediately following this game. We have 3:17 left, and North Carolina will get the ball back. Baylor did not have to punt in this ballgame. Marquise Williams continuing to throw. That got that one to Quinshad Davis. Gain of 19. Davis, with a highly decorated career, rewrote the receiving record books at North Carolina. Three-man rush.
You're talking
and
about
completes it to his running back Elijah Hood.
You're talking about Quinshon Davis. Last year in the bowl game against Rutgers, Davis went up to catch a touchdown pass and broke his leg. Ended up having a stress fracture in the other leg. So he's a guy playing with two rods, one in each leg.
Williams really showing a lot of guts, fighting to the end here. Gets what he can, taken out of bounds at the 30.
Well, Williams is the senior, and I've been talking about the backup, Mitch Trubisky, but I get the sense that this is for Williams to be able to go out with the ball in his hands. He's had such a tremendous career.
Williams deep down the sideline has this completed inside the 10, Damian Washington. And Larry Fedora said he has seen Marquise Williams slide once. He just won't do it. And you would think if there's any time he's going to slide, it's right now. He's half beaten to a pulp in this game.
He's had a nice game, though. Struggled a bit in the
yes,
ACC championship game.
Throws over the middle into the end zone. That's a touchdown, North Carolina. They just will not quit. Singleton makes the grab and another strike from Williams.
Here you are, 220. You get the extra point, you're down 11, touchdown, two-point conversion, and field goal. So this is not over. I assume that they will do an onside kick after this. But this is Singleton playing that position we saw earlier in the game. Brandon Fritz was playing, who left with a concussion, unfortunately. So nice, accurate throw into coverage, and Singleton, who's more the blocker, makes the good catch.
Where there's 220, there's hope. They're down by 11. Later tonight, after the Advocare V100 Texas Bowl, which follows us, stick around for SportsCenter at night live from L.A. Stan and Neil will have all the highlights from all the bowl games, the NBA, the NHL, and college hoops. SportsCenter at night after LSU and Texas Tech on ESPN, as well as streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
Well, watching, we're talking about onside kicks for Tar Heels fans. It's a bad subject. In the ACC championship game, offsides was called. Now, this angle is not exact, so it's impossible to tell if the plane was broken. And the officials watch on onside kick offsides more closely. However, I think Larry Fedora was right to be mad. That if there was a body part offsides, it was probably a finger. And that ball was recovered. Now, North Carolina still would have had to go down and score and get a two-point conversion to tie.
But they showed they could.
But exactly. They had some momentum then. But now you're going to see the onside kick. And I promise you that no North Carolina players. It's kind of odd that he's on the hands team, but he is a fullback and a tight end.
Certainly on the all-beef team.
Yeah. But that play, that offsides, is not reviewable, unfortunately, for the North Carolina fans. But the fans of the Tar Heels, the last time they had an onside kick, it didn't quite go their way because of the penalty.
They get that nice high bounce, and that ball is batted out of bounds by Baylor. You are not allowed to bat the ball.
Well, you can bat it backwards, not forwards.
Good
to gain
call.
To gain territory.
Yeah, you can bat it backwards there. You just can't bat it forward in the field of play or anywhere in the end zone.
And that's, you know, Doug, that's actually, it's interesting you say that. It's really good that Xavien Howard knew that. Because I'm not sure that that ball's not going to be recovered by Switzer if he doesn't knock that ball out. It was a terrific kick by Freeman Jones that jumped up, and Howard, who's a cornerback, not a receiver, so sometimes you'll see receivers on that hands team, did a wonderful job of batting it backwards, which is legal.
Correct.
We showed that offside call from the Clemson game. That may be the 27th time I've seen that play. I still haven't seen offsides. Have you?
Well, the guy who called it said he clearly saw that they had broken the plane, and it's just like the neutral zone where the ball is. As soon as you cross into it, you break it. I don't think it was offsides. It's not reviewable, but the call was made.
Johnny Jefferson back in the ball game. They fake it to him, and the keep by Lynx Hawthorne. Jefferson right now at 289 yards, a chance to get to 300 in this game, and a chance to get to 1,000 for the season if he does. That's amazing. The way he's smiling, somebody told him. He at least knows that he's got this shot.
Yeah, you go to the last game with 701, you're not expecting to scratch the surface of 1,000.
No. No, you're hoping for 800.
And what just an unbelievable job by the offensive line for Baylor. They were down a guy, too. We talked about all the skill guys were out. Pat Colbert, the right tackle, out with a shoulder injury. We've seen Blake Muir, usually the left guard, playing right tackle. Blake Blackmar, a redshirt freshman coming on strong, has had to play a bunch up there.
If you're trying to find LSU Texas Tech, they have kicked, and it is on ESPN News, so you can switch over there to see it. Jefferson. Four, maybe five.
I get a sense, Mike, someone at Baylor did realize he's close to 1,000.
I hope so.
Yeah, that's what this feels like. It feels like they want to force, of course, North Carolina to waste, to get rid of their timeouts, so they've emptied the bucket of Carolina's timeouts.
He needs 5 yards now. He's come so far, it would be a shame to see him not get it.
Here's the problem, though, is if Baylor picks up the first down, with North Carolina and no timeouts, they wouldn't have to run another play. They could knee it. They could take knees to run out the clock. But I'm not so sure you get a guy this close to 1,000, you don't get him 1,000. And that's an interesting thing about this offense. 5 years in a row, they've had 1,000-yard receivers. 6 years in a row, they've had 1,000-yard rusher. So we've been talking about what this offense does. Well, if Jefferson gets 1,000 a night, they'd have 2,000-yard rushers this year.
He needs 5 yards to get 1,000 yards. He needs 6 yards to get 300 in this game. There are probably even some Carolina fans out there that said, let him get 6 yards. Get this over with. Jefferson. No. Still going to need one more carry, at least.
Well, you got to, you're going for it on fourth, on a punt. There could be a block. There can be.
Oh, he has 990 yards and 298 in this game.
You got to give it to him on
fourth.
Holy
cow. Jefferson straight ahead. He's got two. He did it. Are you kidding? And the fans know it. They're on their feet. His teammates know it. They officially give him 2 yards, he's got 300 in the bowl game and 1,001 for the season. What a remarkable effort for Jefferson. And now they're saying it's 299 and 1,000. He still needs one more yard for 300-yard rushing.
Yeah, but the 1,000 is the big deal. Congratulations. And Baylor doesn't even have to run any more plays if they don't want to. Got to be careful with the – yeah, there's the kneel.
Yeah. At least they didn't let Jefferson kneel down and lose 2 yards.
That would have been something. And he has been taking the snap quite a bit. But what an amazing night, and what a cool story. Baylor comes in here without their top two quarterbacks, without their top receiver, without their top running back, like they had to finish the second half in the Texas game, and Johnny Jefferson comes in and goes over 1,000 for the year. What a neat story.
Yeah, all those guys, all those missing parts, and they only got 49. Just amazing.
Well, they were averaging 60 a game before True. Seth Russell was lost, so they have come down a tick.
So North Carolina will finish its season at 11-3. Baylor wins its 10th ball game. They came in ranked 17th in the country, even though they had lost 3 of their last 4 games. That's how much respect the committee had for Baylor's firepower. For Ed Cunningham and Dr. Jerry Punch and our entire hardworking crew, Mike Patrick saying so long from Orlando. Now we send you to Houston for the AdvoCare V100 Texas Bowl.